Back since we really adorned the gold.
Alright, we are started!
Sorry, Sentry, you're not on the list anymore. I forgot to put you in the initiative list. You can't play.
You're lacking an initiative.
I had the door boss, though. The door boss did exist.
Can I be the door boss?
You can't be the door boss.
Dang it!
We get an audio?
Should be. I have to wait until Twitch goes, so...
Alright.
It's fun to just stand here as we're, like, getting ready.
I'm just gonna wait a minute. I don't wanna speak to our adoring fans. You're... What?
That's safe.
Yeah, see? Okay. Well, it's because the last few times when I've had to repeat it a bunch.
It's...
You know, I wasn't trying to throw you under the bus.
So I think it's the first person who gets...
It's fine. It's just because it's been
that Candyland.
It's always something. You know what I mean?
Just don't fall down.
The it rain. Is always don't something. That's how these things work.
Uh-huh. And you got to be careful of the rain.
Hi,
Brandon.
Rainbow Woods.
The candy cane forest. What about Gum Drop Mountain?
All right. We're just checking to make sure audio is working, and then we will launch into things and stuff.
Alright,
back after these messages. Good? Oh, hey. Welcome, one and everyone, to another edition of 5PG Does D&D. Tonight, we are raffling away another game. Every dollar you donate to the stream is one entry into the raffle. The game tonight is Costume Quest by Double Fine. An excellent game. Steam, right? Yep, it's a Steam key. So, if you have Steam, it's awesome. Let's see. I think that's the only announcement we had for today. We are down a few adventurers, but we shall press on.
Forward!
Say for wine?
Forward for wine!
For wine would also
forward
work.
For ale!
Wait.
When last we left our adventurers...
Very eloquent.
Thank you. They had retrieved some very important relics of power, laser pointers. Namely the gem of Doomathorn. You did not get a laser pointer. Sorry. Not yet.
I can wipe it off.
Great job. They retrieved the gem of Doomathorn, took it back to the dwarves. It reacted very favorably with the corrupt gem. And as a result, the undead dwarves appeared to be purified and strengthened, as far as the party could tell. That is basically where we left off. There were shenanigans in between. If you have not watched them, you should do so, either through Twitch or on the YouTubes, as the kids call it. And I believe the party had just finished speaking with the dwarves. And you were deciding if you were going to rest, move on, what you were doing for the day. So, scene. What would the party like to do? You're now surrounded by yellow, light, glowy dwarves.
Slowpick
skeletons.
Is there a round to kill?
Dude, rest.
Okay.
You have already rested. You see a large warforge and a half-orc and a dwarf.
And then a bunch of dwarves that are already dead.
That's your party.
But they're like half
dead. Wait a second.
They're like what?
The dwarves, they're dead, but they're like a little more jolly now.
No.
Like Night Before Christmas dead instead of
no.
Pirates of the Caribbean dead.
No.
Okay.
They were pretty jolly, apparently.
They're fairly jolly. Yeah. So what would the party like to do? You are fully rested if you did not already mark that down. You should recover all of your spells.
Me also?
Sweet, I got my spells back.
Oh. Me also?
No, you're at one hit point.
Ah.
Yeah, your health is back.
Put oil on you and you can act again.
They oiled you and whatnot. You're fine.
Oiled
me out good. So also... You may recall... Sorry, I have notes between three different documents because...
Organization.
That's how I am. You had been speaking with Gorath Bonesplinter about going back up to the surface and assisting them with trying to kind of reunite the dwarves, the Calcazine, with the dwarves up above. So that's kind of where things... I forgot you had already had that conversation.
So we should do that, man. Ivory.
All right.
How about you, Simon?
Yeah, that's a great idea. Sciatica. Simon is not with us this night. Sciatica, you know, gets the best of us. He took roleplaying a little too seriously. So the Calcazine set up a little party for the surface, of which you are a part of. You generally make it back up through the tunnels fairly uneventfully. Once you kind of get towards the top floor that you had sort of been at, you know, where you had fought like the frost giants and certain members of your party became deceased and all of those things, you notice that there's quite a few dwarves of the alive variety that are kind of pacing around and keeping guard. Do you approach them or do you, what do you do?
I'll shoot them.
All right.
Just kidding. Just kidding.
Roll damage.
I don't even have to hit.
Yeah, he's automatically hit. They're unawares. You're an ally.
How many are there?
How many dwarves?
Yeah. Like a lot?
7.
All right. Is there one that looks to be in charge?
No.
7.
Right. 7. There are 7 dwarves in charge.
I will approach the 7th one.
You count
Dopey.
Them.
Dopey. Yeah.
You approach a dwarf. He brandishes an axe and raises his shield in a battle posture as you approach.
Hey, bud.
I stay back hoping we'll kill him.
I just assume that the rest of my dwarf party is with me, and then I'll look unthreatening.
Is anybody following?
I'll follow. Yeah, I'm approaching.
Alright, so you all follow. He starts to relax, and then he sees the undead dwarves. Oh, what's that? And he kind of like raises his weapon again, and the other dwarves, you can sense that there's quite a lot of tension in this little room right now as the undead dwarves approach.
Oh, it's alright. It's your cousin, probably.
Hey, calm down.
He's just coming to help out. What's your name? Eh?
Calm down! There's the walking dead right there! And he kind of, like, starts to move at them. And then the undead dwarves, like, don't really make any sort of aggressive gesture or anything like that. They're just kind of waiting patiently to see if you're going to take charge of the situation or not.
If that was the walking dead, it would be very interesting and I would want to watch 7 seasons of it. However...
No one wants to watch 7 seasons of the current one.
These are the Calcazine. Right, that's the word.
Hi.
They're allied with you and they want to speak to the king. There's a relative of the king. I wish Simon, who took notes, was here to to tell you the name of this fella, but Gorath. Bone chewer. Bone breaker. Bone haver. Bonehammer.
That's okay.
All right.
as Gorath speaks, the dwarf tenses up a little bit more.
Bone splinter.
You'll get it. You got it. Don't worry. There's kind of sort of this weird tense moment, and then all of a sudden, the dwarves drop their shields and they go up and embrace the undead dwarves. You kind of hear like bone crushing. You're pretty sure it's from the dwarves that are alive and not the dead dwarves. You're not really completely sure. Those of you that are not dwarves are not completely sure why they would do that. Those of you that are more accustomed to dwarven culture realize that there was just sort of this brief, tense standoff, and then they realized they were in a threat. And it was basically like, oh, you're a dwarf. Oh, you're a dwarf. All right, dwarf bros is pretty much what just happened. So, Rigger, you're maybe a little perplexed by what you just saw. Tension, friendship.
No, that happens all the time. That's the only way I have friends.
That.
They're not killing the skeletal dwarves that they previously helped. They're helping the skeletal dwarves go up to the surface so they can form some sort of alliance. But obviously, you know, alive dwarves see undead dwarves, and there's some questions that may arise from that. So that is why. Dancer chat. Great. So you've traveled for quite a while. You might want to consider resting a little bit before moving on. The dwarves have safety and provisions that they can provide you with, so you don't need to use your own, if you would like.
Sure.
Aye. Great. So, the undead dwarves of Calcazine decide to go ahead and keep watch along with Sentry, since, you know...
That's what I do.
Let's see... Nope. There we go. Sentry, in your kind of powered down, almost meditative state, you are visited with strange imagery in your mind. You recognize the image of your friend Bibbledore, and you kind of have like this vision where like you're sort of looking around, and when you kind of look at your hands, they're meaty and fleshy, very dwarven, and you're kind of looking at, in this sort of almost out-of-body experience, you're kind of looking at Bibbledore and you're like making adjustments to the armor he is currently wearing, and it looks very similar, if not identical, to the armor he actually wears now. And then as you're kind of having this moment, you sort of feel this, if you could have that sort of feeling, the thing you can relate it to the closest is sort of like a nostalgia, like a fond memory. But that is quickly ripped away, and kind of out of the corners of your eyes, there's this black energy that starts creeping in, and then suddenly, you are back to normal, and you're looking around, and you're in the same cavern with the dwarves keeping watch and whatnot. Gorath is watching you incredibly intently, though he says nothing.
So much.
Rigor.
Wait, are we entering High Hall already? Have we done that yet?
No. Rigor, okay. You are having a fairly normal, pleasant dream, and then suddenly you can feel yourself falling in the dream state, and you smash into the ground. And as you kind of look around, the ground that you are atop is actually like this putrid, oozing mass of sludge and decay, and you can kind of see off into the distance a rather rotund figure holding aloft a wicked-looking sword and laughing maniacally. And then you wake up, but you feel an odd sensation running down your arm, like your left arm. It kind of has a weird, almost itch, you know, like when you have like a wound that hasn't been properly healed and it's a little infected, something along those lines.
Do I see anything?
When you look at your arm, you don't see anything. You don't see anything.
I don't see any diseases.
Exactly. But you feel not quite yourself. You definitely didn't get a very fitful night's rest. And you kind of cough a little bit, almost like you're ill.
That's just my voice. No, that's just regular.
And it turns into a fish.
When we go to High Hall, we're going to the king straight away, right?
Aye.
Well, they're all asleep, so...
Oh, I thought we were awake.
You're not.
Hey, guys.
morning happens, you're awake.
When we go to the king, we're going...
It's like some adult drug addict.
We're going to go straight to the king, right? Now. Right?
What is wrong with you?
Don't worry about it. We're just going straight to the king, right? That's the plan. I need a yes or a no.
Aye, that is the
all
plan.
Right. I'll meet you there once we get out of the tunnels, all right? So don't worry about me. I just might pop off for a bit. You know, take a
where are you
bit.
Off to?
Yeah!
He's looking for the side quest.
Don't worry about it.
Say no more.
I'll meet you at the king, and then I'll meet you back at our rooms.
Very well.
All right.
Okay.
Have a good day.
So is the rest of the party prepared to take off?
Almost.
Okay.
Bibbledore, I believe I may have had a memory.
Sentry.
This is... Yes! What about?
Yeah, what
I
about?
Recall... I thought you were leaving.
Not when we get out of the tunnel. Don't worry. Keep going.
It was while I was... meditating. I seem to remember, I think, that I was making adjustments to your armor.
Aye, that sounds right.
Did I fashion your armor in my previous life?
You created my armor.
This is most curious.
Good job.
I must speak with those who made me.
Indeed you must. Doran wasn't plagued by anything.
He's darn nerd.
He doesn't.
Scratching as much as darn nerd. make a rash.
Are you... yeah, you like the actual rash. Are you, like, visibly scratching a lot, or, like, is that...
It itches, right?
It does, it itches.
I don't, like, try not to scratch very much, so...
Sentry, you might notice that he's scratching a lot, especially if he's close to you. And you've been adventuring for a while. That might seem a little bit strange to you.
It's just fleas.
Or fleas.
That's a little orc disease.
Yeah, I think so.
You can get my armor.
I don't really know. I've never met my dad. I don't think. Could have. Might have killed him on accident. Who knows?
All right. So, Marty sets off.
Yeah,
you get outside the tunnels.
Once we're getting close to the exit of the tunnels, I like to stealth off away as best I can.
All right,
and then I like to stealth as long as it takes me all the way to where the king is.
Stealthing all the way. So you basically, here's the idea: you leave the tunnels, and then you have a little bit of a journey, like up some mountains and some hills and whatnot. Then there's the bridge. And then you're actually in High Hall.
So whatever it takes me, like creeping from rock to rock. Like
all right, so you, as soon as you leave the Tunnels of Legacy, that's when you want to start heading in that direction.
Like, yeah, probably like 100 feet away, I'm probably going to start splitting off from the group and going into hiding mode.
Okay, so the party gets out. Alive dwarves freak out for a moment, stop freaking out, more hugging, more arm wrestling,
blah, 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 doing fine.
You know, you know the stuff that they do. At that point, you may now stealth.
Not actual 20. 25. 22. Yeah, 21.
So.
It's alright if you guys can see
that. Where are you going? The entire party is very aware of
you. I'm going to, like, leave them. I'm, like, not going to stay close.
Well, they still see you. Like, well.
I mean, they can stop me if they want.
What are you hiding from?
Is that what it always looks like when he sneaks
just like you crunk. Can see me?
Why?
Just like, no.
Emperor's New Groove. You're not very good at that in the daylight.
Is it too late to do this?
Yeah, probably say it's too late.
Yeah.
That's all right.
Well, like, maybe if once we're going for a while and I notice that they're still looking at me, can I, like, try again?
You can if you're trying to hide
I'm
from them.
I'm not going
to
care. Like, I'll...
No, I just want to, I mean, they're just going to be motivation for me to realize that I'm not doing my best. And
you're maybe not doing a great job.
Obviously staring at you.
Oh, yeah. No, there are other dwarves. They're noticing your departure.
I rolled a 4. Can I try again?
Yeah, go right ahead.
A little better.
I was hoping it was going to be like a 2 or like a 3. You're just going down.
34. You guys see me now?
No, I doubt. Nat 20. I'm just kidding. Oh, man. Close. I got a 19 on 20, that.
27.
All right. The dwarves neither where'd see nor care in regards to your departure.
He's probably getting some for that itch.
I know not much of illness. Is he ill?
I hope so.
The one cleric in the group could have looked, but it was like, yeah. Orc.
Filthy orcs. Deserves to die.
The more you scratch, something you do notice is your skin has dried a little bit and you're kind of peeling off some.
No, I'll try to stop scratching that.
Well, that's part of why you might think it's itching is because of the peeling.
Oh, so I got like a sunburn.
Better burn.
Oh, shoot.
Tunnel burn.
I knew you should have some lotion on
that. That's what happens. You stand too close to the fire all night.
It's all that magic light that Simon needs.
So the party is going to make their way probably slower than you will in that direction. So you can stealth into High Hall?
Yeah. Okay. Whatever I have to do, if I have to fly over stuff, hide around buildings, whatever. I don't want anyone... The main thing is I don't want anyone in High Hall to see me until I get to the king. Just so I'm not beating around the bush all the time, so you know what I'm doing. I'm trying so no one that may give me a fish knows where I am.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
great.
At least we're clear.
At this stage, I can safely say that you've gotten through the gates and no one has noticed you thus far. We'll say you've had to use some of your boots of flying to do that.
How much time?
How much time on your flying?
Yeah.
Maybe only 10 minutes or so of it. So at this point, you would be, let's say you're inside and the party is probably approaching the bridge at this stage.
All right.
So you're not making great time, but you're very stealthy.
I'm behind them, correct?
No. You're in front of them.
Oh, okay.
You went ahead, yes?
Yeah.
To go in while they were slowly kind of making their way. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. Then you are ahead of them. You're inside. You're in front. But you're just not making great time, so they're kind of starting to catch up to you.
That's fine.
Okay. So now that you're in High Hall, you
stealth your way.
You make it very, very far. When you get to the king's kind of like chamber area, one of the guards spots you and raises his crossbow.
Ah! Who goes there?
It's me, some very important guy.
Orcs! I don't recognize ye!
I'm, you know, the team that went down to clean the legacy of tunnels. You remember?
Can't say that I do.
Well, King Grumblehead knows me.
Oh, you insult a king now?
No. I just very good with dwarf names.
Like, five dwarves come over, and one starts cuffing you.
Cuffing me?
Nice note, yeah.
Can I... Wait, hold on. Grumblebeard knows me. Really, if you take me in right now, I have good news for him.
Let an orc see our king. I think not.
I did it like a week ago.
They cuff you.
Can I do... They have to... They just automatically do it? I can't...
They start cuffing you. I mean, if you resist, that could provoke something. So it's up to you.
You won't.
You can try.
Wait, how close am I to the throne room?
So we'll use these figures. So we'll use Bibble as the door. You're like right here. And then there's like
a dwarf guard's perception.
I'm a solid dwarf.
Okay, so where am I?
You're like here, and this is a door. This is not the actual king. This is like the door to his room.
How many feet away is that?
It's 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35,
yeah.
40. So you have five dwarves around you now with more coming in.
I'm just going to try to teleport him.
These dwarves are extremely well armored.
Yeah,
that could be
real. So they begin to cuff you.
I'm assuming you can't fly over the gates. It goes all the way to the ceiling.
That was correct. It's like a ceiling and then heavy stone / steel / mithril / beard the door. You see the little tufts of beard kind of in there. Well, you don't because you're not there, but you know.
My beard is made out of door.
All right, fine. Someone might be slightly irritated with you later, just so you know. You might get a little bit of a talking to for this.
Unlikely.
Probably not much, honestly, but...
They cuff you, and they begin relieving you of your weapons.
Oh.
When they get to your hand crossbows, they start talking excitedly in Dwarven and kind of examining them, and they look back at you kind of repeatedly.
Yeah, it's dwarf stuff.
Kind of do one of that, and then one of them pockets it.
Can I mark that? Can I very study that guy thoroughly so I know what he looks like?
Sure.
Like every aspect of him I'm studying so I know what...
Are you trying to use your...
I'm trying to look for his name badge as well.
He throws his name badge away.
I want his officer number.
He's in Diego Montoya. You think you could probably pick him out in a pretty dense crowd.
Oh, wait, what's your name?
He says nothing, and you are escorted kind of like out into the bustling city.
Did he take both of them?
Yeah. And you've been relieved of your heavy crossbow.
Yeah, who took that?
Your two hand crossbows. So the two hand crossbows have been like pocketed by that one dwarf. Okay. The heavy crossbow is just being carried by one of the other guys, like it's being set aside most likely.
Does my target acquired thing, like, we never really...
Never really explored if it's...
Yeah, like, would I know where he was if I was, like, far away from him?
We can... I never really designed it with like, a non-hostile action in mind.
Yeah.
We can probably do that here. I don't really...
Sure, I'll do that for him.
Yeah, I kind of figured that's what you were getting at. Yeah, that's fine. We'll consider it non-hostile. Okay. I don't think that's a big deal. So, you are taken a fair distance, and you are put into a holding cell, and your heavy crossbow is set aside... like on a weapons rack kind of thing. Did you have other weapons on you? Did you still have the rapier?
Yeah, the rapiers.
Cool. So you've been relieved of those as well.
And what else?
Everything.
Ooh, a...
All of your gold now.
Do I still have my goats?
How much gold do you have?
Oh, man.
1,553.
What?
They relieve you of 400 of that. And they divvy that up kind of amongst themselves. Can't hear anything that they're saying, but they're still, because they're still speaking in Dwarven. Were you hiding your goats? I don't really
recall. Oh, I did. I did hide my goats.
Yeah, I felt like you hid them.
Yeah, I hid them very well.
Where did you hide them?
I don't know.
In my pocket.
Who really knows?
Nah, they don't find the goats. That was a very low roll. And then whatever other, like, miscellaneous stuff you had that wasn't, like, very expressly hidden, you've also been relieved of. So did you get all that? You've been relieved of all your weapons and 400 gold, but not your goats. So you've always got your goats.
I have my goats. There's a thick metal rod. I don't know.
Oh, the movable rod?
Oh, I guess I have the movable rod.
That sounds about right. They would have taken that. Cool. And they also... one of them very acutely recognizes that your boots are exceptional. You're relieved of your boots.
Wait, am I in the cell?
Not yet. You're surrounded by 10 dwarves.
Still up there.
Yeah. You're going to be in your cell very soon. But yeah, you get relieved. They attempt to relieve you
of
your
boots. Is this the same guy?
No, different guy.
I study him too.
You can't target the choir both.
Okay, but I just look at him a lot.
You're gonna get a court martial or something.
So, at least you've got the goats. So yes, they take your boots. He kind of like measures to see if he'll fit into them or not, and then he takes off his soldier boots and kind of puts them on. Kind of gives them all. You kind of see that they stretch a little bit in a couple of areas. And then he takes them off and puts on his other boots and just tosses your boots aside.
Can I mark where they went?
I mean, they just puts them over there, basically by in the weapons rack.
Oh, okay.
And now you are in the cell.
All right.
And now the party, about this time, should be entering the very similar area where he had been.
No guards.
That's, all the guards are gone. It seems like a flaw in their plan.
I turn out of a door and go up to the door.
I was like, what?
No longer a door.
Just put you over there. And then the party gets there. You know this, the same guards. There's a bit of an exchange between... the people that escorted you here. Oh my god, and the dwarves! Oh my god, and the dwarves! And that whole thing. You do notice a severe lack of rigor, of course.
As expected. Well,
he didn't know he was going here.
He did say he was leaving, yeah. So...
He didn't know that. He didn't say he was going here.
I thought you did.
Nope.
Not to us.
He said I'll meet you there.
I said I'd meet him there.
I thought you said you'd meet us in their rooms.
I said I'd meet you at the king. No. And then after that, I meet you back at the rooms.
I don't remember.
Well, there you go. There is no rigor of the trigger here. All right, great. No one's asking. So
maybe he's not. Maybe he's behind us.
After, yeah. That's possible. You didn't
know. Yeah, didn't know how long he was going to be gone. Didn't know where he was going. Now.
Let me know when I have enough opportunity to look around.
Sweet. There are, just so you know, there are quite a few guards that are positioned there. I'll kind of describe what's going on for you, since we're going to launch into their thing shortly. Basically, you're in a fairly small cell. It's not well kept. There's kind of like human refuse kind of off to the side. It smells pretty bad. Periodically, guards are coming down and they're like trying on your boots, and then eventually one takes the boots and sets off. The others, you do recognize him. Like, you don't recognize him, but you kind of commit him to memory. Not the same way as like your target acquired.
Right.
Your target acquired is back here, basically. Your other possessions, few as they may be, seem undisturbed thus far.
And is there a guard like directly in front of my cell?
No, there are six.
Think of the threat. All right.
So you couldn't hear what they were saying, right. But the general idea you get is they didn't like that there was a half-orc sneaking around, and he showed up outside their king's room, and there's other stuff that I may not give you since you couldn't hear them.
I can't understand.
But that is generally the gist you're kind of getting on why they might be on high alert. So yeah. There are some other cells down here, though they appear mostly empty, though there is like 2-3 cells over or something like that. There is a dwarf kind of hunched over, snoring very loudly. You assume he's very drunk and was probably put in here. He might have been too orderly, since disorder dwarves is pretty common. Alright, and now enter here. So, you are permitted to enter the king's room, should you desire.
No, I...
Yep.
Great, so you open, they open the door for you. And you see the wonderful sight of King Grumblebeard with his large beard being draped over different pedestals, with his, you know, dwarven beard maidens brushing it and taking care of it and whatnot. And he sits up out of his throne when the group enters. Obviously he recognizes you, but his eyes are fixated on Gorath at the moment. Gorath approaches, and Grumblebeard kind of starts to move towards him, and without a word exchanged, they just embrace. And now you can hear that there are bones cracking on both sides. You come to find out that Gorath was actually related to Grawl Grumblebeard. He was you kind of try to keep track of it. He was like a second cousin, twice uncle removed, times three kind of thing. But in Dwarven, like, that's a big deal. So they're very happy. Do you explain kind of more of what you found down there? Do you go into any details?
Aye.
Good job, everybody. We're really role-playing it tonight. How did you come by? Milan lost second cousin's third brother thrice removed.
Twice. 23. Twice. Sweet. Aye, they be down there blessed by Dumathoin.
You speak his name. What, pray tell, did you see?
Some caster had a gem that clashed two gods, Dumathoin being one of them.
He seems to understand this. Oh, I see.
Aye, strange crystal. Battle. Gods.
Oh, fire good. He seems to take in everything you're saying. He is paying more attention and hanging on to your words much more than obviously he had previously. Since previously you were kind of, he just assumed you were going to die. He also speaks at length with Gorath about what's going on in the tunnels and this, that, and the other. After all is said and done, he says stuff that I took notes on. Yep, there we go. Oh, you didn't, I forgot you asked that guy's name and I had it for you. He was Drogbin Gormar, down the tunnels when you had asked his name.
So close.
My apologies.
Goreth.
No. Completely different guy. You had asked what his name was when you approached them. The seventh dwarf.
Oh. Yes. Dopey.
Yes. So... he kind of looks out and he motions out to like a, it's not like a full window, but it's kind of like a little slit where you can see outside.
The weather has cleaned up quite a bit recently. Now that you've,
God, fucking accents, can't do it tonight.
Whatever you took care of down the tunnel clearly had an effect out here. If you desire to go back to your home, we can provide a ship. We have the Kazmorin.
In Dwarven, that is Floating Mountain. And he goes on to describe an impressive vessel. It is an ironclad behemoth at a length of 130 feet. The Kazmorin is an old Dwarven warship that has seen many years of service. It is well protected by iron reinforcements and armor surrounding the hull, and moves at an impressive 8 knots despite its weight. The secret to its impressive mobility is the form comes in the form of steam power machines created by dwarven engineers. 5 impressive cannons line each side of the large ship, with a massive battering ram and cannon adorning the front, in the shape of an ale cask. Everything about the ship is ornate, from the carvings on the hull to the etchings on the cannons themselves, which are designed to look like a dragon's head. Some might say it looks something like that.
Ooh. Oh, snap.
It was a ship! Miles. Guess the Object.
You had, like, 2 things drawn out.
Like, is it a swimming pool? Like, yes.
Well, you had a surf up the back and the base ship.
So, we'll get more into that in a moment.
Nobody knows.
I'm hope you guys are. So, this is what I was hoping.
First time you really see Dorn look really happy.
So, he's just described it to you. You haven't even seen it just yet.
Oh, I long to see.
Oh, you shan't for long. So... he goes on to mention that now the weather is cleared up, they'll happily give you passage back over to where you came from, so you can hopefully investigate more of what's going on with the orcs and, you know, that whole plot line.
You mean him?
Yeah.
He's the only one that's come from anywhere else.
Yeah. Yeah, wait, hold on. We don't have a home to return to.
Well,
isn't this all of our homes?
Yeah. We wish to return home.
I'll just go down the street.
So
I don't know. Need a ship for that.
So you see, this is when the DM completely forgets that half his party got slaughtered, and the original plot points have now changed.
And the only one of the original group is in a cell.
Is Simon there?
Yeah, I mean, is Simon with us? Simon?
No, Simon has sciatica and went back to his room.
He's back in his room now?
Yeah. So, he goes on to mention,
wasn't there a half-orc with you?
Yeah, he said he was going to meet us here.
Yeah. He described that there were great troubles back in the realm of men. That might be worth a look into, considering what you've run into already. Yeah.
Just screaming from the dungeon.
I agree.
Where is that blasted half-orc of yours?
Do not know. He did not say where he would be.
You see one of the guards, his brow moistens a little bit. It's like,
I think I knew where he is. I'll go get him for you.
And goes back. So he leaves. You continue to kind of talk a little bit. Also, you are offered some extremely potent fine ale. It comes from this just massive cask that is completely made out of mithril. And as he pours it, you can kind of see like almost little magical sparks coming off. And then you realize it's not magical sparks, it's gunpowder that is colliding with other things and causing those sparks.
I eat my kind of ale. This is my private reserve. a shirt with you on the job well done. We'll see that you are properly compensated before you leave for your journey. I thank you again for all that you have done. You exchange in conversation. The dwarf that you had target acquired comes back in dwarven. You can see that he is talking rather quickly to some of the other dwarves.
Does he look nervous? Or
he doesn't really look nervous. He looks more like
embarrassed?
Flustered.
Okay.
Dwarves aren't embarrassed.
All right.
He just looks flustered. And he kind of looks back at you, and then he points to your feet, and one of the other dwarves kind of shuffles a little bit and says something, and then this guy leaves, comes back, hauling the other dwarf by his beard, and then, like, kicks him in the feet. The guy takes off his boots, drags your boots, and then he also takes out his your hand crossbows. So he goes up to your cell, opens it up, and starts undoing your shackles. He starts saying something in dwarven. You just look perplexed.
I said thank you, and then
in common,
yes.
All right, I forgot you don't speak dwarven. Apologies. You understand it's my job to protect my king.
Yeah, he's all right.
He's all right because of the job I do.
I jingle my coin purse.
Aye. Sorry about that. Can't do much about that one, though.
Oh, I think you can.
Not good, though.
He hands you your stuff back. Except for the 400 gold.
Alright.
Okay. So does he escort me back into the king?
Yeah, he does.
As we're entering... the, the hall, I would like to try to slide a hand my gold back off of him.
I mean, he doesn't have all of it. Like, it was divvied up a bunch amongst
the dwarves. Can I try to slide a hand some gold off of him?
You can. It's not the gold. Like, he didn't take your gold.
Oh.
It would have been the other dwarves down there.
Is there anyone else coming? Can I steal from anyone?
I mean, you can try to steal from him. I'm just letting you know this isn't...
He doesn't have it.
He has gold, just not your gold.
All right.
It could be your gold, if you get my drift.
Should it be my gold?
Should it be my gold? My dice is ready if you want to.
I mean, what's the worst that's going to happen? Just go back to jail?
just kill him. No witnesses.
I've already been in jail. No, I'm waiting to go into the hall. So if I get in trouble, it'll be in front of King.
Yeah, so
that's better.
Basically, back where you got arrested, there's maybe 10 dwarves in there. They're not really paying too much attention to you since you're being escorted now. And then he is kind of keeping step in front of you.
It's just 400 gold. That's just, you know, two adventures, that's all. All
right. So, you enter into the hall, you are greeted by Bibbles just drowning himself in this amazing ale, the king looking jollier than you can remember, and then Gorath also looking rather jolly. Doran, potentially jolly, are you participating in this ale fest? Oh yeah, you're having a good time.
Sentry's having some. This tingles.
You... As you, as it starts to, like, hit your throat and stuff, your little explosion kind of descend into your interior.
And does little else.
And so that's the sight you see, and then dwarves start hauling in, like, entire boars that are, like, ablaze or raw in, like, different states of cookery. And the dwarves just start eating and drinking. It is a night filled with revelry and wonderment.
Is the guard who took my boots in there?
No.
Okay.
He is not, because he got sent away.
Got sent to the timeout corner.
Yeah. Yes. Apparently stealing hand crossbows is fine. Stealing boots is a sin.
I don't have to reattune to those, do I? Do I?
Yeah.
Alright. Well, I guess while we're having a feast, that's what I'm doing.
It's a long rest? Short rest?
Short rest.
Short rest. It'll be fine. Yes, but it's not going to matter. How is that for you? Except...
Everyone's at attacked. Roll initiative.
Okay. So your night is filled with festivities. You are again offered rooms at no cost. As you do, you go back to that inn.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sure. I sneak back.
Okay. So you go back to the inn. And you can roll stealth checking one, sorry. You're greeted basically as heroes, and people are embracing you and giving you free drinks, free food. Obviously, news has spread.
Is there another Battle Ranger buddy floating around? Yes. Sweet. Totes. Grapple. Fight. For funsies.
So there's a big grapple fight taking place. Armor is locking into each other. They kind of get stuck, and they sort of do this weird barrel roll into, like, different things, and the dwarves are having a good time. And they're, like, throwing gold onto the floor, betting on different combatants and whatnot. What was your spell?
28.
28? All right. Yeah, you are free to go to your rooms, you're free to order drinks, you're free to talk to people. There are all manner of creatures here. There's dwarves, gnomes, what else was there? Dwarves, gnomes, elves. There's another race that's in here.
Doing my normal drink until I pass out and wrestling.
Kind of figured.
The folks who crafted Sentry, are they around?
Not in the inn.
They're not here, but they're somewhere else, I take it.
In theory.
Okay. I would want to go find them to talk to them.
Okay.
Share my memory.
Sweet. So, Doran, what are you doing? We'll get on the line here.
I'll hang out at the inn.
Great. You hang at the inn.
Drinking, hanging out. Nothing in particular.
I don't really see anyone...
Relaxing.
You don't really see anyone that you feel would be a threat or a concern. You see... You smell that there are some dwarves here that have the scent of the ocean upon them. And you would guess that they may even be part of your crew for the morrow. Noobles, we got what you're doing. I'll do him and then we'll go to you. So what are you doing?
I want to wait until it gets quieter.
Okay.
Like downstairs. like, not as rowdy. Like.
Well, did you go back to your room already?
I wanted to sneak back to the room, yeah. And like.
Well, they had to give you a key to go back to a room. So
I figured I'd just climb in through the windowsill. So.
There's not really a whole lot of windows.
All right, well, so with the innkeeper, I'd like to... is there, like, a fireplace?
Yeah.
And we're being treated like heroes, correct? We're
being treated very well. You're offered free food, free drinks.
So I take out one of the talents, and Tibius's hat. And I tell the innkeeper that I'd like it placed over the fire with a plaque saying what he did, and that every time someone reads it, they have to buy wine. Or some, like, some. They have to have fancy wine, needs to be sold. And he was a hero who helped clear out the. I just ask him to put up a plaque in honor of Tibius and his sword and his hat on top of it, and wine needs to be involved.
And wine needs to be involved. All right. Take your inspiration. I don't even care if you already have inspiration. I figure if I just drown you guys, then you'll eventually start using it. Although, I only have this much left, so... I actually gotta make sure that there isn't one floating around someone else's thing. So, he agrees to do that. I will do that right away. And you can see he motions to, like, some helpers, and they already get to work doing
make sure you spell it right. Tibius Sprite's battle.
Ah, for no. He was a gnome, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Forever.
Tibius is more the lies of the mystery.
Sprite's battle.
So, after some hours in Dwarven... And they write the plaque up there. You assume it says exactly what you wanted.
Yeah.
Some of the dwarves go by, like, there's a dwarf there.
Who was Sprite Spittle? Yeah. He was a good man.
Hey!
Hey!
I'm just doing that because there was a toast.
Yeah, every time there's a toast. And you start to see that there is wine now being distributed. The innkeeper also hands you a key for your room, should you desire to go up there and rest.
Yeah, go up there.
Cool. So when you go up there, your room looks nice, and there is a fish head on your pillow.
I knew it.
Yes. All right. I just scrape it off the bed and let it fall on the ground. Just
a little parchment kind of falls out of its mouth.
I'm not going to read it.
All right. Do you just leave it on the floor?
Yeah. For now. I mean, I'm going to get it in the morning.
A rat crawls into your room and starts gnawing on the head.
I don't care.
All right, Mr. Sprite Spittle. I'm sorry, Sentry.
Sentry cries a single tear. And does not know why.
Oil just leaks. So anyway. You want to find the people that created you, yeah? Yeah, I should have anticipated that and had that open. I don't know why. It's poor planning on my part, that's why. Okay, so after a little bit of searching, you manage to kind of find the area with quite a few folks that you recognize, kind of like engineers, wizards, that sort of thing. Wizard!
Some
magical mumbo jumbo. And you recognize like a tabard that is kind of blazoned on some of the people that are doing that, and you see more of your kind sort of assembled in the area as guards.
Greetings. Something has happened. I believe I have had a memory.
A memory? Well, that's not unusual.
For me, it is. I have not remembered anything since I was created.
Let me have a look at you.
And he kind of crawls up on there. And he starts...
climbs up me.
Okay. He, like, straddles you on, like, kind of on your shoulders. Takes your head. Gives a big old lick.
Yeah, that's how it works.
He takes his elbow and he kind of does this.
Boom, this boom, is boom. Normal.
Oh, hi. You're a little odd, aren't you?
Aye.
He kind of just slides down. He gets his beard kind of caught and has to get it off your armor.
Ugh. All right. All right, what do you want me to do about it?
I was hoping you would know more.
Would you like to know more?
We don't really have a whole lot of your kind with that problem here. Usually the Gauss Quorum works just fine. Though there have been a few that have been a little off lately, not the same as you, but,
aye.
Problems.
He kind of looks you up and down. He starts tapping your knee and just kind of doing things like that. He does a lot of beard stroking.
He's like, I'll tell you what. Let me get my commander. He might know a thing or two.
I will wait here.
Two what?
I will wait here.
About 4 hours passes by and he never comes back.
I continue to wait.
Another Gauss Quorum comes over to you. What seems to be the trouble?
I have no memories, but I appear to have remembered one thing.
That is very strange. That should not be. When did you have this memory?
Just earlier today.
He kind of looks
last
you...
last night? Whatever.
Recently. He looks you up and down. He doesn't quite give you the same treatment that the other important person did. Who totally knew what they were doing. But he kind of confirms the same assessment that something's definitely odd. I've never heard of such a thing occurring with one of our kind.
Nor have I.
This could be a very important discovery. He goes on to question you about how you were made, what you were like in life, and all of these things. He's basically just trying to get as much information about you as he can. Do you hold anything back?
No. Yeah, open book.
Sweet. So basically nothing, because you don't really know any of that stuff.
But so I do share the memory in as much detail as I possibly can.
What is the name of the one that you travel with?
Bibbledore.
Ah, yes, I know that dwarf well. You did indeed travel in life. And he goes on to confirm that you made his armor. After some further discussion, you find out this is a battle rager who had actually served with Bibbledore. And he was put into the Gas Quorum somewhat recently, but yeah, he seems to be...
Battle rager buddy.
Yeah. You also notice that, maybe more for show than anything, he's got some spikes on his armor as well. Kind of as a nice call out to that. He basically tells you that you should keep track of when this is happening, and that you should periodically send reports back to the Crafters Guild here in High Hall. The leader, whose name I totally have written down here, is... You ready?
Go.
His name is Cazald... Cazald...
Is that with a sky comma?
It is with a sky comma.
Yes.
Cazald Sootbeard.
Fuck. Sootbeard?
Sootbeard. I was looking for it. That's K-H-A-L sky comma Z-A-D Sootbeard.
Got it. And
what is the best method for contacting Cazald?
Oh man, good thing you asked. He hands you a magical looking stone. It has a dwarven rune on it. It says here, take this. At any point that you wish to impart knowledge, simply squeeze it, think the thing you desire, and it shall make it into his hall. The name Sootbeard is fairly familiar to you. You kind of get the impression that might be something that you want to speak to Bibbledore about.
About the memory?
About Sootbeard.
Okay, gotcha.
Because you also kind of get the impression that Sootbeard isn't in right now.
Ain't here.
Cool.
Cool. Is there anything else?
Well, that other dwarf said he'd be back. So I'm going to continue.
Why do you wait?
The dwarf said he would return.
Ha! Tis a jest. He knows nothing. He simply cleans our area. He does have a brilliant mind for the mathematics, however.
He just pauses sweeping and finishes equations.
Sometimes we call him Will.
That's a good name.
Yeah. So,
I see.
I would not anticipate his return until tomorrow when his shift begins.
Very well. I shall return to the inn.
His buddy brings him in.
He has anger issues.
Go hunting for him.
All right, great. So you head back to the inn. It's pretty late. You see Bibbledore is now stuck to the wall, as if someone picked him up and just planted him in there. And there are, like, ale casks, actual casks that have also been, shoved into him. And it kind of looks like what they did is they punctured a cask and set it in such a way that he could just sit back and let it, like, pour into his mouth. So he is covered in ale, stale urine, a whole bunch of other fluids. It's just... He looks about like you'd expect from Bibbledore. You also notice that his armor is not getting clean. It is staying nice and filthy from all the revelry. You see Doran also having a pretty good time. Dwarven lasses sitting around him as he tells tales of the high seas. Doran, there have been a variety of... sailors that have come up to you and swapped stories. Your earlier assessment is
tales.
Your earlier assessment that a lot of these will be the same crew that you'll be a part of tomorrow is accurate.
Sweet.
And Rigger, you're asleep with the fish head being on.
Am I still itching?
How long has it been?
A day?
The itching appears to be going away for right now.
Alright.
Four. No, we don't need Simon to clean anything. Don't give him ideas. Alright. And now I'm going to say the party is resting at some in some capacity. So let's start with Doran. Do you go back to your room to sleep, or do you sleep out there?
I go back to my room.
Cool.
I'm civilized.
You
for a dwarf.
Doran, you have this interesting experience where you kind of start to have a nightmare, but your subconscious self just tells it to screw off.
I am sleeping.
And you sleep very well.
That's fantastic.
Bibbledore, you're not quite so lucky.
Star, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm napping.
I'm taking a rest.
So, Bibbledore, you have a nightmare, yet it's almost like a wonderful dream where you are in a lake, and the lake is completely made of blood, and you start to kind of sink and you find your footing, and as you're walking there is a pile of bones that seems to be leading you out, and you kind of look out into this field of a glorious battle taking place between demons and men and dwarves, and it is the bloodiest thing you can remember. A part of you is incredibly excited at this prospect, and you kind of go charging off. But there's another part of you that kind of has this odd sense of dread. You see a imposing, heavily armored figure with this helmet that rises up like this, and he is holding aloft a bloodied axe. And then you wake up. Sentry, you ponder the meaning of life. But nothing more. Rigger, you have a similar dream to the one you'd experienced the other night, but this time you're looking at the town of Moor, and in your dream there are scath that are basically inhabiting it now, and they are taking human prisoners and just lifting them off elsewhere. And you see Urosh in your dream as well, completely disfigured with like appendages sprouting from him, and that immense Etten that had cast the spell that teleported you guys. Well, didn't teleport you guys here, was going to destroy you, then you got teleported to where you are. You see him also completely disfigured and changed. And in your dream state, you almost feel as if they can see you. When you wake up, the itching is even worse.
I have a cold handprint on my arm.
And when you look at your hands, you can see that your skin has kind of bubbled a little bit. And then everybody wakes up. And that seems like a great time to take a break, because I know you need to check the gables. So we will be back in 10 minutes.
Ooh, rush.
Roughly. Roughly in the 10-minute range.
Roughly.
Alright.
We're back.
So we're still kind of on break. There's still people restrooming and whatnot, but we figured rather Smack. Than just listening to the music, you could hear us discuss things amongst ourselves. So, yeah, still got about another minute or so. Yeah, we can retcon it a little bit if you want to where basically you were asking, let's say, the barkeeper someone. He's like, oh, I can have someone fetch you some books on Doomathon.
That sure.
would be more than fine.
Like what he did for the rest of the night?
Yeah. I think that's totally fine. And you guys will be getting fat boots in the form mostly of gold.
I like gold. Ah.
Yes? What?
Yeah, like, oh, come on.
Huh?
I don't know what it is.
Boy, who could you have kept me keeping a secret from?
Obviously you, but how would you even know?
Go ahead and text me and I'll see whatever it was you said.
Are you on Slack or something?
I can be. Yes, I'm on Slack on my phone. We'll be back from break here shortly. Do you still have stuff to do?
I was just blasting on the chat.
Cool. We are technically on right now. Just saying.
Hold on. Do you like eggs?
Do you like eggs?
And what are you afraid of to me? It's the Germans.
Oh, I saw there's a new season of that on Netflix now.
Season of...
Of Dags?
No.
Oh, Peaky Blinders?
Yeah.
You said Tommy, I've been watching it already.
Yeah, well, I haven't. I've been too busy catching up on Game of Thrones.
That's a different voice.
I've been too busy catching up on Game of Thrones.
Oh, Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
I don't know if I want to answer you or not.
Alright, double door, let me see.
Better.
I like the whole thing. You liked it too. You watched the whole thing. You liked it on some level, you so should. Get real.
I haven't seen it.
Get real.
Get real.
Watching the whole thing.
I see.
You're about to throw me under the bus here. like,
Thomas Shelby.
Right now.
Nice, Thomas Shelby.
Oh! I kind of figured that actually.
He's like, right.
He's like a secret agent.
I was like, I'll make some stuff up, I guess.
No big deal.
Whatever. You're into that kind of stuff, which everybody is, so I know you are.
Sorry, I was getting a few things sorted out and making sure the sound works. So let us know if the sound is a little bit better. We'll probably start again here real soon, guys, so don't wander too far.
Andy
and I just
watched the first season.
Okay. So good.
Yeah, I saw spoilers.
It's fine. It's fine. Wait, there's a third season?
That's down.
There's a new episode in that season?
I don't know if it was
new. I didn't want to hear this stuff.
I'm pretty sure it was...
What's the third season?
Yes, I already know that. I'm just pulling your... animatronic leg.
It's just stonewalling you. Oh, guys, I'm so excited. Thunderdome should be here tonight.
Oh, yes! Yes! We're playing that at game night.
Alright.
I have to get back to my gravelly voice.
Also, don't All forget right. to donate. Every dollar you donate enters you, is one entry into our raffle, and the game we're giving away tonight is Costume Quest from Double Fine as part of a Steam Key. You get that, Bibbledore? Did you get that nine. Super awesome information?
Yep.
Sweet. All right.
All right. And we're officially back. So, welcome back.
Guess who's back?
Check for traps. Everyone.
Back again?
Roll for initiative.
Maybe soon. Oh, that's what I forgot to do. That's fine. Look, just because you saw me putting markers on a bunch of minis during the break doesn't mean that you're definitely... 100% gonna run into combat, just most likely. All right, so morning has come. Your books on Doomathon arrived early in the a.m., which you've probably been pouring over Sentry. And then Bibbles kind of wakes up. He's still on the wall.
Was that a cast?
How do you always manage to get up there?
Do you need a hand?
No, I'll get it.
Did anyone Did I hear through at any point of this feast, the feast, that there was a ship willing to take us back home? Or do I not know about that?
It was mentioned to you.
Okay.
That there was a ship that was trying to take you guys back home, and that there were tales the orc invasion was getting worse, especially near Moor, and that there were also some of the reports you heard coming from Elmarch was very akin to the stuff that you would run into in the Tunnels of Legacy. Green glow, yada yada, that kind of stuff.
Right. They weren't so can hard I pick to
up
kill.
The, can I pick up the note now?
We should kill the rest of them.
You can.
I agree.
I'll read it.
It is blank.
I'll lick it.
The message
it tastes like fish.
It tastes like fish.
And rat.
Alright, so the rest of my morning I'm going to spend getting Simon ready, and I'm just assuming that the dwarves are going to stay here. So I'm acting like I'm getting ready to take Simon on the boat, and we're going to leave, and I'm going to give my goodbyes to the dwarfs and kind of dwarf.
Where do you think you're going?
We're going to head...
There's more of these things to kill!
So you...
Boat! You're not keeping me away from the boat, lad. Your green skin can shove it up your bum.
You should have just left it a boat.
Boat.
It's intimidating.
Boat. 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 Boat.
The other sailors start kind of joining in.
Boat.
All right. Yeah. There's a boat.
The seagulls.
All right.
Seagulls?
Will you join us? Well, maybe you have another orc to be with us.
I feel like you're joining me. It's our place.
Come along. You shall be useful to us.
It's my trip. You're coming.
Yes, come with us.
You'll be safe, lad. It's all right. I can protect the boat.
I'll protect you.
Nah.
It will be an honor to join you all on the boat. Back to Moor that none of you have ever been to.
Well, I've been to Moor.
Oh. How many more times would you like to go?
Is that supposed to be a joke?
No.
Your humor's terrible.
Did you think about it? I don't know.
That did sound like a serious question.
Are your fingers out of sort? Great. So... as you're kind of getting ready for the day, so Simon is not in a great state. He's pretty much down for the count. You've also noticed that Yada is nowhere.
Toyota.
You also noticed Toyota disappeared shortly after you returned to the city. You have not heard from her. You have not seen her. She has just gone missing.
Not the first time, indeed.
She's gonna miss the boat.
Rigor.
Yeah.
You, as you're kind of preparing for the day, you find on Simon's person a note from her. It's pretty succinct. It basically just says, "Don't wait up. Have things to investigate, and I'm better off on my own."
Yeah, because I'm very good at the team.
It is true.
She was always running off anyway.
All right.
Well, looks like she left. So,
More for me to kill. All
right.
Yeah. More for you to kill.
As a special note, she wrote that in Orcish.
Yeah, you can read this.
I can't read anyways.
Yana did not die, but she has ventured off to a land unknown. So, is there no sound, or have I got something wrong here? Hopefully,
there should be sound.
Yeah, if you want to check and make sure there's sound. Some other folks sound. Alright, perfect.
That's totally sound.
Just making sure, that's a very important thing that you can hear.
Just stare at us.
randomly mouthing and like.
So, you also have members from the king's court come in hauling large chests.
Oh yeah.
And they place them at the end. A bunch of dwarves get excited. Like, not for you lot. It's for them. Maybe a little bit for you lot. Nails on the house! And they buy a round. Not with your gold, with their own.
Okay.
So, in total, there is 20,000 gold. The party may distribute that amongst themselves, however they wish.
How much?
20,000.
Cool. Hold on to that. Nope. What?
20,000.
It's for the boat.
Divided by it's not for the boat.
4,000.
We might need more cannons.
No. 4,000 each. That's just fine.
Okay.
Bibbledore.
I can take yours if you don't want it.
No, I'll take it.
More crap for me to carry.
I'll take it.
Yeah, so indignant about getting 4,000 gold. Like, yeah.
I will carry your gold.
Sweet.
Oh, I see how it is.
You just give me all your gold, or
no? Just the
4,000. Just 4,000. Okay.
So Bibbledore, also one of the dwarves, comes over. And he has a rune, and he unwraps it from a fine cloth. He's like, here, lad, put this on your armor. Let's see what happens.
I hold on to it and look at it.
You got that. You recognize the dwarven writing. It's definitely magical in nature.
Sweet. Can I get the wrapping?
Yeah.
From it? I wrap it up and I pocket it for now.
Alright. Okay. That's cool. It's great. Good. No yelling on the bus.
Don't worry about it. It'll be fine.
And then... Yep. So that's what you have. There's no other loot inside of there. Just, you know, a whole bunch of gold.
How nice are the chests?
Pretty elaborate.
Can I sell the chest?
No, they take the chest back. Nice. They're made from mithril.
Ooh.
Yep, complete mithril.
Are you sure we won't spend
it? They're solid.
I could use a new helmet.
They take it back.
I think that...
They take it back. You are ready to set on your wondrous sea voyage.
Before we do that, I want to go to Hrothgar.
You go to Hrothgar, not Hrothgar.
Ragnar.
Hrothgar. I was given this, but since you're the maker of my armor, I feel you should be the only one to alter it.
Hmm.
They said just to shove it on.
Shove it on. On what?
My armor.
So, Sentry, you recognize this as a very powerful magical rune. You've seen things like this where great warriors have been given these kinds of things to greatly enhance their armor properties permanently.
Hmm. And I remember how to use it.
You do.
You just shove it onto my armor.
You just shove it on.
That's what they said.
I know that. Do you not think that I don't remember to do
that? I don't remember what you remember anymore.
I shove it on.
Ah.
Nothing happens.
Ah.
Try
apply it properly.
You apply it properly. So what you see is there's a bright light and kind of like this burning, almost sizzling, just and you see it slowly kind of disintegrate basically into the armor, and then the rune is etched on there where you had slapped it. Bibbledore, you have +1 AC.
Nice.
Deal.
And you get +2 to grapple checks.
Deal.
Yes. Alright. Where'd my AC go? Right there.
Powerful magic.
Yeah, you definitely recognize there's something very magical that just took place.
I didn't want
I didn't want you to freak out. That was going to happen.
Yeah, that's totally fine.
I was like, no, don't be angry.
I was like, it's fine. I wouldn't blame you. You did have a wizard just clean your armor, and like, I also would be very cautious.
Well, he made it. He made my armor, and he's the only one that I'm allowing to change it.
Aww. So sweet. When's the wedding?
We're thinking March.
Got a long wait. So, is there anything else you'd like to do in town before we're setting off?
Great. When we get down to the docks, yes.
Sweet. So, you approach, you get down to the docks, and it is, you see the ship. She is quite impressive.
Sorry, just before we leave the inn, I'd just like to look at the sword and the hat one more time before we go.
Still there.
And then
did you have one of the rapiers?
I have one, yeah. But cool. I'm leaving the memory of him and never going to think about him again.
Smart plan. Yeah. That's what he wants.
Yeah.
That's what he wants.
All right. It screws with you when you're doing intelligence checks or wisdom checks or whatever it was.
So, here is the way the ship works. As I said in my description, she's 130 feet across. Obviously, drawing that on the map was going to be very difficult. It's also why I didn't bother following up with you by the boat, because once it turned this large, I was like, doesn't matter. So each square, instead of being 5 feet, is actually 10 feet now. So that will be important when you're considering things like movement, etc.
What?
Should you encounter some sort of naval battle, weird like that might happen, there are a variety of skill checks and things that I will allow you to do. Keep in mind that there is a crew of 80 dwarves. Not completely represented on here. These are like groups of dwarves. These aren't just individuals, with the exception of this guy, who is the captain, my captain.
Is he our captain, though, or is he just your captain?
He is the ship's captain.
Okay.
And that is what you see. It is basically, as I described earlier, large, iron, monstrous beast of a ship.
So, as we get down there, taking in the fresh salt air and being mesmerized by the sea yet again, and we get to the boat, I want to stop at the gangplank before I get on the ship. And I want to kneel down and do just a blessing to Martha Arduin for safe travels and for to thank him for his continued support of my travels and deeds. And kind of, you know, just try to bless the boat before we take off.
The crew...
making a big show of it.
Crew greatly appreciates it. The captain nods to you, and they kind of do a chant.
Yeah.
So, I would give you another inspiration.
No, I have plenty.
Yeah, you don't need more. So
I'll
good.
Use them someday.
Someday, maybe. Possibly. Great. So, you are free to board. The ship is well provisioned, and also, if it wasn't clear earlier, the reason why you're taking the ship now, because I realized I didn't really go into a little great detail on that, is Goreth had great concerns about what still lay deep within the tunnels. He didn't feel comfortable sending you guys on through on your way until they'd had the proper chance to clean out, which could be months of time. And since the weather had cleaned up, it seemed as though the safest travel was probably via sea, and so enter boat. I had a little note on that, and then I kind of skimmed over it, and then I forgot. My apologies.
So, where is it we're going?
More
right. What? More ale?
More like 2 hours. Oh, you can't read.
More water?
No, it's a town. Its name is Moore. I've already done all the jokes on this town, so you can't do any. You're all done.
That's jokes?
It. You only get one.
So, Rigger, you may recall that where you are headed... Let me actually see if I can get a better view of this. So you can't go directly to Moore from the sea.
It's not Elmarch, right?
Elmarch is kind of like the continent. You're going to be going to Elnar, very close, which has either Elnar or Talman. depending on some of your preferences. The time is roughly the same. If you dock in Tallman, it's going to be about the same distance, really. There's no major difference.
They're both cities on the same continent. They're not... Which do either...
One is just a little bit more southerly, and the other is just a little bit more to the north.
Do either of those routes go close to... What's it called? The thief land? Thief city?
Oh, Galgoza? So, the way you're going to get to your destination is you're going to have to take the boat. You're going to have to kind of go up and around and kind of come down. You will technically pass kind of Galgoza. You'll see it off in the distance, but they're not going to get super close to it.
Okay, so either route goes that same way.
Yep, because they're both on the western side of continent.
Which do I know anything about either city?
You know a little bit about Elnar. It is in the south, which means it's near the lowlands. Skirmishes with orcs has been fairly frequent in that area. Had you continued on after the fort, you would have eventually reached Elnar. The fort that is probably no longer a fort. Tallman is further to the north. That is usually it's a human city, but occasionally there are dwarves and other northern folk that tend to frequent it. You don't really know a whole lot about either city. Tallman is fairly close to Highmarch, which is the capital in Elmarch. So they typically get a lot of trade back and forth.
So Elnar could be compromised. Do I think that's a possibility?
That is a potential. Because the crew needs to kind of... Because they need to go roughly the same way, the captain has kind of decided to wait until they get a little bit closer before making that final decision. But obviously at any point you're free to chime in. The journey... should take you, if you're going at 8 knots, should give you about 17 days of travel time with fair weather. Did a whole bunch of math on it. It was really exciting. I opened up a spreadsheet. I went to town like, all right, this much and this much travel. Great. High point.
Okay. I won't make a decision then right now. We'll just kind of see what happens as we go.
Great. So, you're on a boat. A fine vessel. To call it a boat does it a disservice.
What's the name of it again?
The name is...
The USS...
It is the Cosmoran. In the common tongue, it is known as the Floating Mountain.
Did I meet the captain at the inn, or just some of the crew?
You just met the crew.
Okay.
Upon getting on the ship... This will be the first time that you've actually officially met the captain. His name is Brinebeard. And he does not appear to have a first name, just Brinebeard.
Cool. Brine or Grine?
Brine.
Yeah, okay. Making sure. so I would go... I would go straight to the captain.
All right, you go straight to the captain.
Hail, captain!
Welcome aboard my vessel. What can I do for you?
Thank you for letting us on your boat.
Aye, that was quite a blessing you gave us earlier.
Been a many years since I've been on the sea, and I'm glad to return.
Glad to have anyone that can pull their weight.
Kind of looks around to the rest of you. Kind of scoffs a little bit.
I don't know how well they'll seafare, but they can fight.
Mm. All right, it's good to hear.
I'm still, putting my foot down, testing the ground. Trying to...
Cling, cling, cling.
He kind of looks to Sentry.
Suppose that one might make a good anchor, should we need it.
Probably, yeah.
Sentry looks confused.
We'll just tie a rope to him and send him on
there. Talking about from
what sort of magic makes this much water? It goes as far as the eye can see.
Yeah, it's called the sea, because you can see it forever.
Yeah, that's why it's called that. That's right.
That does add up.
Makes sense.
Sorry, I was just taking that in. I've heard that joke before, but still caught me off guard. I'm not salty over it, though. Don't worry. So getting back to the current events.
Oh my gosh.
full of hot air today.
Okay, can we just wave
past
this?
You, the ship begins to set out, and you can see, like, billows of steam kind of coming out from back here. So, in case it wasn't clear, the way the ship is laid out is there's the cannon and then also the battering ram on there. And there's cannons on the sides. This is where all the steam power is kind of set up, and it's got some coal things and other such machinery.
Is there still sails? Or, like, masts that sails can be applied to? Or is it just the
steam? So the way it is set up is there are currently no sails, but you can see that the floor will kind of open up so that they could crank up sails given an emergency of some kind.
Sweet.
Question.
Good to know.
Ooh. Does the battering ram have a flat surface to run on?
yeah, because it looks like an ale cask.
That's awesome. There will be momentum.
Good to know.
that will be my main form of traversing.
I wonder how far you can fly at 8 knots.
We're gonna find out.
There you go. That's kind of the general idea. So yeah, you could run along that.
This is bound to happen, letting you know.
So it's not
start thinking of those
true
mechanics.
Alright, so you set out there and you're pretty far along.
As soon as we set out, I'm going to bust out my navigation tools.
Nice.
And I'm going to start making sure that he's setting us on the right path.
Perfect. The captain approves of this, and he actually he looks over to his navigator and he's like,
watch out below deck and get some rest. I think we have an able body up here.
The navigator looks a little bit perturbed, but complies.
It's fine, lad. I've been doing this for over 100 years.
He looks very surprised. He's like, alright. He doesn't actually go down, though. He actually stays close by and starts watching what you're doing very intently. So, you travel the first day fairly uneventfully. The dwarves seem pretty jolly, pretty confident. The ship is full of ale, plenty of good food, dried meats, etc. You each have quarters you can rest in. The ship is rather spacious, so there's quarters kind of for the important people, which they deem you to be.
Yeah, we're important.
Bloody gauntlet. High five.
You've also noticed that many of them seem to speak in common most times, though when the captain is speaking to Dorne, he does so in Dwarven, and while it's Dwarven, but it's a very highborn version of it. Like, you would basically gather that this was likely someone who has seen a lot of royalty in his time, probably a noble of some sort, who decided to take the seafaring life. Not particularly common for Dwarven royalty, but it does happen. So, first night, Dorn, you are able to rest very peacefully. You feel very at home in the open ocean. Bibbledore, you rest kind of embedded out here on the mast, just sort of, or not the mast, sorry, the battering ram, just kind of hugging it. For a while, as you try to go out there, dwarves try to stop you.
Can I tie my rope around my waist and around, like, something that's anchored to the boat, just in case?
Yeah.
Sweet. I'll do that.
They try to stop you until you kind of do that, and then they just give up. And then you're all right, well, never. Some of the dwarves actually suggest using you as a projectile of the cannon. I'd like to see that. The cannon that sits here on the front is massive, by the way. Like, this thing is huge. You're pretty sure one good shot from that would sink most normal vessels. Sentry. You meditate peacefully. Rigor, you are not plagued by nightmares either this night.
Nice. Is there a crow's nest?
No. Okay. There is no crow's nest.
It's a boat. Why would there be a nest for crows on here? There's no mast. Why would there be a crow's nest?
But they put up the nest, so
I don't know.
So we could.
Well, there's no. None.
Yeah, they haven't put up the mask, but they could.
Know. I didn't know if they just had one out for looking out or.
Nah.
Yeah, they don't need to see stuff.
Yeah, they feel very confident that they can overcome whatever comes their way.
You got me.
I mean, if there's icebergs, they just melt through it.
Right, you know? Right.
Oh, every single dwarf on here has a very elaborate beard, by the way. You don't see a clean shaven one amongst them. So the second day, you're kind of navigating for a while, and things seem pretty good. In the distance, however, you see sails. Dorne, you would estimate, they're maybe a couple hours away. It's a very open ocean, very clear skies, so it's very easy to see them out there.
Do I make out any flags, markings?
Do you have a spyglass or anything like that?
Oh, I don't. I have navigator's tools. Aww. I don't know what that would include.
Hmm. No one has a spyglass. We can say you have some sort of spyglass, because I think that'd be. So, go ahead and give me a perception check.
Actually. I perceiving.
We can go get spyglass for you now.
12.
It was non-magical.
You don't see flags, but you do see the ship is of crude design, and you see green skin. Creatures manning them.
They're probably orcs.
Have you ever seen orcs sailing before? That seems unusual.
It is very unusual. You are very shocked at the sight before you.
Does he say anything?
Captain! Am I lost? Or are them orcs on them boats?
Dead?
He takes out his spyglass and kind of looks like,
oi! What are they doing on the seas?
Can I, who has spyglasses? Both of them?
They're speaking in Dwarven at the moment, but yeah.
Oh, so I don't even. Do I know the word for orc?
No.
Right. I'm just chilling it.
Yeah. They're also not like, yeah, no. It's like, that's very uncommon.
Should we go find out what they're doing?
I think that's a great idea.
Boys! Let's get ready for a fight!
Ah, ha, ha, let's do it!
what it's
Vivaldor starts sliding off and kind of. He falls off and bangs against the side of the ship as water sprays you in the face. And you kind of look down, you see massive sea creatures swimming around. Yeah, just like megalodons and all that kind of stuff. No big deal. And you kind of like hoist yourself back up. Pretty uneventfully. The crew starts speaking in common, and they're basically kind of doing a little chant.
Let's go kill some orcs! Let's go kill some orcs!
Very excitedly. So you hear that. A few of the crew kind of look your way, Rigger.
Hey, didn't you like chants?
I'm, what was the question? What'd you say? I didn't even
know. Don't you like chants?
I said, don't you like chants? Because they're chanting.
A couple of dwarves are you.
Let's go kill some orcs! Let's go kill some orcs!
I'm a half human, so it doesn't bother me.
Wasn't worried about bothering you, lad. But you turn on us. I'll get you from bow to stern.
Well, I tend to yell things, but don't read into it. It'll be fine.
Right, so, the party may take, if you would like, you can man a certain part of the ship. And what we'll do is we'll have a variety of skill checks which may be involved with the success, the failure, etc. Obviously, the crew is manned. But you are free to take a position if you so desire.
I take battering ram.
I'll follow him. I don't know what to do here.
Just don't get in front of the cannon.
I'll stand right behind the cannon.
All right, so you're going to be like...
Hey, Captain, what's the range on this boy?
Watch and find out.
So he... First, let's establish where everybody is, and then we'll do that. So, you're behind the cannon.
Actually, I'll be off to the side of the cannon. I want to be able to see in front of us.
All right.
Perfect.
Bibbledore, you're like...
somewhere where I can get a running start.
Right in front of the cannon. Gotcha. So
behind the cannon.
Well, you like yeah. maybe run along it like...
yeah. Boop, boop, boop. Yeah, that's pretty much what I mean.
Exactly. Okay. Dorn?
Is the back of the boat got like a raised platform, kind of thinking traditional boat in here?
Yeah, yeah.
That's where I'll be. I'll be on the back of the ship.
Cool. So you're going to be... kind of the way I kind of imagine this is it's sort of right here. I actually should have drawn this out a little bit more right there.
Sure.
And then like you kind of have the stack behind you.
Okay.
You know that this would be the most vulnerable position of the ship since that's where a lot of the propulsion comes from.
Exactly.
Rigor?
I'm going to whatever side of the boat is obscured from the orcs, like the poop deck, I will hang off the back of it hiding. So either on the side, like however we
approach. You want to be kind of back here, maybe by the stack a little bit.
I was going to be like hanging off the back because I'm going to fly at him.
All right. So you're kind of like maybe here?
Sure. Whatever side is going to be concealed on our approach.
All right. That is going to change as the battle continues.
And I'll be moving around as...
All right. So here's the way this is going to work. I'm going to need each of you to make an initiative roll. Now, what this is to do is to determine which one of you decides to go first. What's actually happening is we're going to go on the ship's initiative roll, which means the ship goes, and then you guys go whatever order you desire through rolling, etc. That's what I was going to leave up to you guys if you want to just do a traditional initiative roll or if you just want to decide who goes when. And then on the enemy ship initiative roll, they'll go, etc., etc. So... those up real quick like that's gonna be and then we have ship two. Oh, whoa. Doesn't help if I roll it and then don't say anything. Okay. Alright, Rigor, what you got?
7. A gentleman, 7.
Dorn?
12.
Bibbledore?
I have 14.
Sentry?
9.
I think this is the first time we've gone last.
Yeah. Huh. Okay. Yeah, I guess that'll work fine. Yep, good, great, wonderful. Alright, so once you get fairly close, I say fairly close, it's still a fair distance away. They go ahead and they start loading this thing up. They kind of crank it open and open up the back, and it takes 10 dwarves to take this massive like shell and load it into there. They close it up, they aim. And the loudest boom you ever heard.
Boom!
Echoes throughout. And you see this huge explosion. And
my turn!
And it definitely hits. Oh, yeah.
Combat over.
Murder.
And it... oh. Didn't roll on. Didn't bring out enough d20s for that.
Oh,
yeah. This thing does d20s in damage. So we're going to go ahead and use the app for that. Hold, please. You guys are going to be up real soon, so start considering your moves. Basically, just so you know, it's going to be Bibbledore, Dorn, Sentry, then Rigor. So let me just add some guys.
Number of boats and distance.
There are... oh, wow, that was a really unimpressive amount of damage. There are two ships. They are trying to think of the best way. So that happens. You see the thing hit the ship, and you see orc bodies and stuff fly all over the place. The ship is still sailing, but it was definitely wounded. What?
Green mist.
Yeah, there's a green and red mist. So they're about, just for the sake of this, we'll call them like 500 feet away.
Okay.
Is there a certain range you need to know they get into?
No, I'm just trying to visualize.
Yep. So now it is actually one of those ship's turns.
Yes, I had to open the book for this one.
Okay.
Are their boats larger or smaller than our boat?
So the boat is, these boats are actually so right huge. Now. They're larger.
Oh, cool.
They're kind of like a man of war where they're like stacked higher. Whereas like yours is a little bit lower at the ground. Ground.
Yeah.
Water ground. So they get pretty close. So they get within the 500, and the first ship fires off a very ragged volley. You can see now that they have little catapults on there, and then they've also got.
Are they launching goblins?
They are. You see little goblins on little wings go flying through. Yes! And you see a shark. a few more kind of come sailing in, but none of them hit their mark. But you see a motley crew of orcs. They're just foaming at the mouth, getting ready to come in there for some combat. At this point, we'll say in their turn, they move. They're now 300 feet. That's ship one. All right.
So much to cast.
They've acted. All right, it is now the dwarf ship's turn, which brings it to you guys. Bibbledore, you go first.
I am going to wait until something is in range.
Figured. No.
I do have a question, though. Since I tied myself to the boat somewhere, and when I fell off, I wasn't in the water, I would assume that I didn't do it to, like, the center of the boat, so I can't have, like, full range around it, so am I only, like, in the front half?
Yeah, you're only, like, maybe... Right.
Unless I undo it and then go. That's totally fine. Just wanted to make sure.
Yep. Doran the Storm.
Does it look like they're planning on staying back and shooting, or does it look like they're planning on charging? Or can I even tell from this early in the combat?
Do an intelligence check.
Good at that. Oh, nat 20.
Yes. All right. So from your knowledge of orcs, especially nice. Spending a lot of time with one, you would assume that their version of tactics is getting close and stabbing with a sharp bit. So you probably assume that their intentions are to board the vessel. As opposed to taking pot shots because they're not the brightest.
Yeah. Then I am waiting until the boats are closer.
Okie dokie. Sentry.
Yeah, I'm gonna wait until one of them gets on here.
Okay.
Or I could help load the cannon.
Are they shooting? Is the crew gonna shoot, or do we have to like tell them to fire?
They will act on their own. I'm gonna have them kind of do the last bit.
Yep.
Rigor.
Fire Will!
Oh, poor Will.
Am I obscured from the enemy?
For the moment, but one ship is going this way, another ship is starting to go that way.
Alright, so I'd like to go down towards, like, the bottom, like, towards the rudder of the boat. Like, on the very back of it. And hide.
Okay. I'm not going to make you roll right now because you're completely obscured.
Okay.
So I'm not going to worry too much about some half-breed in the back right now.
Cool.
So they kind of align the ship in such a way that they can fire off a volley of cannons. And they are not actually super great at that distance, so probably nope. Okay. The dwarves fire off a volley of cannons from the side, but they're a fair distance away and they're still training, so they don't have a good line of sight, like, they don't have a good line of fire. And they end up missing the ship.
That's
alright. I mean, that's alright. They just did a whole bunch of damage from this thing earlier, so...
Yeah.
and now is the second ship. It also moves within 300 feet. Launching some gobbos. Nope. You see Agabo comes sailing in, and he kind of lands in the tube of one of these cannons that is getting ready to fire, and goes, and you see a nice flying red and green mist come out of it. So both ships are now within 300 feet. The ship that was here is now within 100 feet. And they're going to unleash some cannons. No, they're not. The orcs. So you can definitely tell that there's a ship over here. I'm just going to start kind of doing this thing. Ship, like, in this direction. It's closing with about 100 feet now. You would guess that by their next turn, they will ram. And now that's going to bring us to the party. The dwarves, just so you know, in case that might impact your planning, are not super concerned about the ramming, and they're going to actually turn into it, and they're just going to fire into the ship because they have balls of steel. So, Bibbledore, take us away.
A3.
You did not sink my battleship.
Whatever. Yeah, I'll just wait.
That was good. That was good. Alright. Doran of the Storm. There are two ships to knock.
I got that one! I'm going to cast... I'm going to cast Control Water Whirlpool. No. It creates a whirlpool cone that is 50 feet wide at the top, 5 feet wide at the bottom, and 25 feet deep. Any creature or object within 10 within 25 feet of it, so that's an additional big, is pulled is pulled 10 feet towards it.
Okay.
Every turn, there's a lot of rules here. Creatures must make strength saving throws or get pulled in deeper. Every creature and object within the whirlpool area takes 2d8 bludgeoning damage on each turn.
Jeez. So are you trying to sink this ship with it, basically? Alright. Yeah, I was definitely prepared for that.
Yeah. You better start thinking of a good health pool for the ship.
Oh, no, the ships have health
pools. Okay.
How much damage is it, you said?
It's 2d8 every turn, and it's a up to 10-minute concentration.
Alright.
Damn.
Yeah, I mean, it's just going to get hit by it. There's nothing it's going to do. It's going to take damage is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
There's no way.
Unless it's strong enough to get out of the whirlpool, I don't know how you want to rule that.
So the way I'm going to kind of rule it is that it's going along, and you maybe center it at, like, the front of the ship.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so it, like, kind of sinks in a bit and starts eating away at the ship. The ship isn't completely submerged, but it is definitely being damaged at this state, and you have halted its ability to do a ramming maneuver.
Sweet.
So it might, like, get out of that by, you know, a turn or two, but it is...
That's fine.
Dead in the water.
Hello. And if any creatures fall off of that, they're pretty screwed.
Oh, yeah. Orcs fall into the water and are subsequently eaten by sharks and other things.
Screeching eels.
What?
Screeching eels.
Screeching eels. How much damage did you do?
Oh,
it does have a health pool.
Eight.
All right.
That's a slow process.
Shrinking eels, man.
Oops. Okay. Well, that ship is probably gonna get super screwed. Anything else?
Nope.
Sentry.
Yeah, I was gonna go to the other side of the ship, but that's pretty much taken care of. You could do the one down to our right.
Yeah, I got the one that's out here.
To starboard?
Yes, to starboard.
To starboard. I'm going to stick around to port, maybe line myself up. Is the other ship coming at us?
Yeah, the other ship is going to be like...
Extend your pole arm. Here. Swing at him.
Yeah, I'm going to do that
too. Get away!
All right.
Yep, that's my plan.
Sweet. Dunskis?
Yep.
Rigger the trigger.
So the boat on this side is currently having flotation problems?
Yep.
And there's a boat over here. Do they have sails up?
Yep.
How far away are they?
They are currently 300 feet, though you imagine they're going to get within 100 feet on their next turn.
Alright, could I try a shot at the sails with an oil arrow?
Nice. Yep. All right. Go ahead. Yeah.
So, I'm hiding, and that would normally give advantage, but it's far range. Does that balance out, or is it still disadvantaged? Because it's a sail.
It's a sail. I would say just roll normally, not at advantage or disadvantage. You have tons of inspiration, I'm assuming.
That's true. 14.
14.
What's the sales AC?
14 will miss.
Really?
Yeah.
It's a tough can. It must be canvas.
As you kind of take your shot and you launch it, it looks like it's good, and then there's a goblin on a little thing.
Meant to do that, I'm sure.
Alright. Yeah, got one. I will hide in my position again.
Alright, yeah.
In the back.
That's fine, there's still not anywhere.
Just screaming at that wasn't so. Sentry, what do you mean?
I'm gonna load another oil arrow.
Okay. So they go, they turn hard, and they dwarves unleash themselves a nice little volley. And they're not at disadvantage this time, so that is going to help. It's going to help. Come on, hey, we got a hit.
I just had an idea.
How about that?
So they fire off a shot, many a shot. Oh, at least that was good damage.
Weird.
And most of the cannon fire misses, but you do see one land a good shot, and you see beams and orcs and goblins fly this way and that. Okay, and now we're going to branch to, so this ship, despite the attempt to assassinate it, gets 100 feet in, same as before. They look like they're going to attempt to ram. They don't have cannons on the front, so they just try to launch some rocks at you guys. Ooh. Nope, wait, never mind. That's terrible. As is that. So they launch boulders from little catapults. They're kind of in the middle of the ship, and they go sailing over wildly. And that's going to bring us back to these guys. What did you say the save was to try to get out of there? What's the deal on that?
Strength save.
It's a...
Or strength something. Strength check. Well, that's for other people. Strength athletics versus my spell save DC for a creature.
Oh, sure.
It doesn't say anything for objects. It just says it takes damage, but I would assume it still would be able to
kind of move as well there. All right, what's the DC? I'll do a roll and kind of see what
my current DC is 16.
Okay, and you said it's what, 50 feet?
That's a 50 foot cone, and then the area 25 feet around that.
Okay, so what I'm going to say is it's not completely submerged in it, kind of like it was before. It kind of rights itself back up, and it kind of starts to go over it. Still taking damage and still significantly slowed its pace.
Okay.
So go ahead and roll damage.
Nice. 15.
Doing more damage than the cannons. Dorn the cannon is what we should call him now. Alright.
Part of my title for being on the open sea.
It's true. So they're still about 100 feet away. They didn't make a whole lot of progress getting out of there. They are also going to try to launch rocks at you guys. Hey. So you see a big boulder come in and take out some of your dwarven compatriots.
No.
You only see a couple of dwarves die to the rock assault. Great. So that
is a rock, or is it salt?
It's a little bit of both. It's rock salt.
Okay.
Sounds good. No, I'm on board. I got this.
On board.
Now it is back to Dumbledore's turn.
Keep making bad jokes, I'm gonna deck you.
I will wait.
You're waiting? What? Yeah.
What? I need someone to get on here so I can punch him.
Alright.
I'm probably just gonna rage just because.
Yeah,
you should. I'm not raging.
No, you should definitely do that.
Nope, not yet.
DM thinks you should do that.
Oh, I'll rage.
You're just gonna clam up.
Joking. Doran.
So, I'm assuming I have a fairly thorough knowledge of ships and their normal construction. What I would like to do is attempt to target where they're storing their powder for their cannons with a lightning bolt.
On which ship?
Yeah, that one that's slowed down. Perfect.
I don't even know what that was supposed to be.
I don't even know if this is realistic.
Sky Comet.
That's what I would like to attempt.
They're not super smart creatures. Is it? It's an attack roll.
Yes.
It would be an attack roll.
Is it lightning?
Lightning.
That's a
no. Deck regular lightning bolt. Regular lightning bolt's the deck save. You can make an attack roll if you prefer.
Let's do an attack roll.
Okay.
Just regular, no advantage, no disadvantage.
Sweet.
And then I have a DC in mind for this. And by DC in mind, I mean there's a chart over here.
Nice. 15.
So, you see Doran kind of come out, channel, and you see the sky kind of turn a little bit. A lightning bolt comes down, and you see this massive explosion on deck as yet more orcs go flying off the side, and the ship has now caught fire. Go ahead and roll 2d20 for damage.
Nice.
Yeah, 13. No, sorry, that's math. 11. God damn it.
Alright.
I think the lightning bolt would have been more damage.
Yeah. 2d20, I'm disappointed. Although my 2d20 that I did earlier was also equally disappointing. Just one of those things. Great. Doran has gone. And that's going to bring us to Sentry. I bet Sentry doesn't do anything.
Maybe. You see that the other ship's on fire? I'm behind the cannon, but I imagine those flames might be pretty high.
Oh, yeah, no, you see it.
Sweet.
Let's just add a little debuff icon.
It's still maintaining concentration on...
Oh, we should also do this. Yeah. It's slowed. It's got multiple debuffs now.
And how far away is the other ship?
Ship number 2 is 100 feet away. This one's about 90 feet. It moved just ever so slightly.
Sweet. I'm going to target the other ship. Sails, just part of the boat, places with the circlet of blasting. And he's going to say, "Scorch the evil before me, and let all wickedness feel oozy woozy and poopy whoopy. Hurrah, hurrah!"
I love you. Oh,
God. That's right. You did it right.
Here's one.
I'm That's so a 22.
Hits.
Okay. All right. So glad. That'll be, I guess that's just 2d6. 4 fire damage. And then number 2. All
right.
That'd be a 9. Imagine that one misses.
9 will miss.
Ooh. And a 12.
12 misses.
But this should catch flammable stuff on fire.
Yes, flammable stuff is now ablaze. So you can see that like the sails are starting to rapidly go up in flames.
Nice.
It now has a slow debuff. And they have that little thing there. Yeah, it's moving much slower as the wind is taken out of their sails. It's like a mustache. Yeah, mustache. And it takes some damage. It's on fire. God. It's like It's like you guys have good ideas or something. All right, perfect. And you guys need to start using your inspiration. I really want to get after that. You know what? I don't care. You're getting it.
Yes. I'm a lot of dolphin.
I've got one more.
Now he has more than I do.
Whoever gets this one is my favorite.
Ooh, time to do some crazy.
All right, so
you get one close enough.
Is that trigger? You want to set fire the ship?
Do I have a good angler on the one that's on fire?
Terrible. That joke was pretty fishy.
Yeah. So they're both on fire now, right?
Yep. They're both on fire and slowed.
Can't fly underwater, can I? My boots don't rocket propel me through the water?
No.
Okay.
I don't think so. I didn't actually look that up, but I'm going to go with no.
It probably doesn't. I mean, they have little wings. I don't know. It's like a little motor in the back.
Wings are the same as fins.
Yeah,
it's perfectly fine.
I mean, I guess I'll shoot an oil arrow at the one that the poop just got poopy whoopied and see if I can accelerate the flames.
Okay.
That's it. So it's within 100 feet now?
Yeah.
Do I get advantage for hiding? It's a boat.
It's a boat.
Sure.
All right. No, I can't see me coming out. All right. That'll be...
You don't roll your dice, you just
draw. At 22.
22 will hit.
Well, it depends if it rolls out of your hand.
Well, I mean, you know.
Well, that dice is balanced. I rolled a 1 and then a 20.
Hmm. Wow.
Of course. Does it know I'm coming?
It doesn't. It doesn't know you're there.
Is the boat surprised?
I don't think the boat's surprised.
Okay.
All right. I don't think you're going to get
your name. What was that?
It's a gazebo!
No.
Someone's saying, grapple the boat.
Oh, it gets close enough.
And lick it.
Yeah, you gotta lick it. Did you lick that bolt before you shot it?
Well, of course I did. When is this amateur hour?
I didn't think it got oil on it.
Oh, gross.
That'll be 31 points. Oh, and it'll add to the fire 31 damage and then another 7. So 38 damage. 7 of that being extra fire.
It definitely doesn't take all the damage.
Because it's a boat. I understand.
You would say that it is extra fiery. It would be a second fire debuff icon.
Nice.
Which signifies it should be taking more damage on its turn. I like this. We should make a board game or something like this. It'd be great. Let's see here. All right. So, Rigger, you have done that.
I'll hide.
You'll hide? All right.
The boat doesn't see you.
The boat does not see you. You're safe for right now. So, the dwarves, are ballsy. And they're going to try to ram this guy.
Yeah, we are.
Within 100 feet. How fast can she move?
6 knots, I believe.
8 knots.
8 knots. Sorry.
We move.
8 garlic knots.
They move 6 knots.
You say that's a big pretzel, but.
Yeah. I'm going to say that yes. Alright, so.
Do you really want to get there?
They start moving in the direction of ramming. It's going to take them one more turn to get within range.
You'd be water walking.
There now. All right. So they get close, and then they also fire their cannons.
Pretty heavy.
Oh my god. All right. So.
It takes time.
Much like you've seen previously, the dwarves are very eager and they're shooting their cannons, but only one shot actually hits it. And this guy... How smart are these orcs? Alright, they're not. So ship number two, you see a bunch of... You see basically what you would discern as the captain going, "Just get in there! Don't let them in us!" "But boss, does that mean we let them in us?" "No, I said don't!" Too late. They were on their course and now they're going to collide. So what you see is the dwarven ship just completely plow into the second ship.
With the momentum of it, can I like run off of the cannon and leap off onto there?
You can.
Sweet. Doing.
Give me a second.
Oh, raging first, by the way.
Let's see. Come on, 60-20.
Show me a potato salad.
So, you see many an orc fall, and the ship has now been breached. What can I do to, like, breach?
A capital B.
You have no imagination.
I'm going to do a capital B with, like, explosions around
yeah.
it.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
I knew what you meant, don't worry. Alright, so...
You're too far away. That's fine, nothing. Don't worry about it.
So it's now
that's all I need.
They're entangled. You're right.
Yep.
Do a roll.
That's what I know.
Do a barrel roll.
So since I'm raging, I get.
Are you tied? Still.
Shit.
You forgot.
I'm doing it anyways.
He can rip the cord. It's gonna be a yo-yo.
He can rip that cord.
One of the spikes will cut it, it's fine.
23. Should I do... That was athletic. Should I do, like, a strength? Or something?
Do a strength. Just well, athletics would basically be strength.
Right,
yeah. So, you see Bibbledore take off, and you can see the rope kind of, like, sort of stop him. Like, he kind of goes, and there's, like, a briefest moment where there's some resistance, and then just... Whoo, it completely severs the rope. He jumps off onto the deck, landing on three orcs. They're instantly dead.
Oh, ha ha! Let me at him.
So these... Did I only grab two orcs? All right. So these actually represent groups of orcs. They're not single one-at-a-time orcs. Like, you're on a ship. There's a lot of green-skinned scum. And they're definitely eager for your blood. I'm going to say that took your turn. Well, all right. You did this reaction. Never mind. You're good.
So that stuff.
Ship did their thing. It's not your turn yet. Oh, yeah. You'll have your turn in a minute. Right. I lost track of where I was. You guys are intertwined. You did the thing. All right. I think we're good. So next is this ship. It is going to limp along. We'll say it gets a little bit more momentum. What's the damage, Lindsay?
Waterball. 11.
11, alright. I don't know. I don't know if that ship is going to get super strong. Alright. Ooh. So they fire off another set of rocks. Oh, aww. Many dwarves died in that one. So you see big boulders come crashing in as 12 dwarves are taken out by the
little... We better learn how to boat.
How many dwarves did we have?
You had 80.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You now have 66.
Is the boat taking damage?
Not so far.
Okay.
It's a very hardy boat. So they've moved forward.
So we'll start mending if I
that's gonna I was hoping, I was like, man, I hope someone has mending. Alright, it is now Bibbledore's turn.
Do you want me to try... I want to grapple someone and try to throw him off the boat.
So here's what we're gonna kinda do for the stuff that I'd like you to do is roll kind of like you're attacking a single one, right. But we're probably going to rule it as if you're attacking like a big battle kind of fight thing.
That's fine. So these are just hordes. So like, I'll just be going through just...
Yeah, you can still, like, if you successfully hit that, you can still throw people off and whatnot. That's right. Not a problem.
Sweet. I'm going to start doing that. I'm going to just start attacking. 15 plus 9.
That hits.
I'm assuming, oh, God. What's the...
Where did that... Oh, I didn't look at that. I'm a bad.
That first one. Wait, how do you want? You want me to just do them all at once, or?
Do your the hits, and then we can do the damage. That might be easier for what I'm doing here. One of them.
Same thing. It's 15.9, and then 20.
20 to hit or 20 damage?
Those were all hits. I just hit
three times. Those definitely all hit then.
Okay. And then.
What the heck? I'm missing stuff. Yes. You got this.
32 bludge piercing.
32 bludge piercing. Here we go. Allow me just a moment.
Sorry.
I lost the thing. That's fine. That worked out really well.
I had to, like, do rages in there as well.
All right. So you see Dumbledore run in there, and he grapples one around the neck and then kind of like pops off his head like that. And then he takes that head and he starts bashing another orc in the face with it, like taking the tusk and just shoving it right into his eye. As that one staggers back, he kind of comes around and roundhouses someone with his fist. And you see him grab another one by like the scruff and throw them down into the water. And you see the sharks that have been circling earlier have quite the feast.
Yeah. I'm about to feed them.
All right. And let's see here.
That's
one of those. Okay. Perfect. And now it is during the storm's turn.
So I'm getting real tired of this little shit missing with the cannon. So I'm going to jump down and push him out the way. So that I can start shooting the cannon.
10, 20, 30. Alright. So, that was your movement. You have 30 feet of movement?
Yeah. Oh, no, I have 25 feet of movement.
Yeah, you made it.
Okay.
You got fed up earlier and you started walking sooner. So, what you can do is you can go ahead and fire that cannon, and I'm going to do a couple of things.
Okay.
What's your highest stat mod? Wisdom?
Yes.
So, roll an attack. Two attacks using your wisdom modifier.
Okay. That is both the same. 21.
21 will definitely hit. So, go ahead and roll
3d10. 3d10? Total or each?
Total.
Mm-hmm. 16.
Great. So you see Doran come over and push one of the cannonmen out of the way.
Let me at it.
Yeah. The dwarf at first is disgruntled, but his disgruntlement turns to awe as Doran lines up the cannon and fires off a very impressive shot and hits it right across, taking a bunch of orcs with it and damaging the ship.
Yeah.
This dwarf now busily starts reloading the cannon.
Again!
And then we've got Sentry.
So, is there an effective bridge? Can I just get over there easy enough?
Yeah. You might want to make a balance check of some kind to make sure. Because, like, this, you're pretty much deep inside of the ship right here, right?
Yeah.
So... You're gonna have to like make some sort of balance. Okay, so, like, okay. What athletics?
Athletics is like
or acrobatics.
Running.
You're good at that, right?
I'd prefer athletics.
So acrobatics, yeah. Athletics. Yeah. Go ahead.
That's a plus 6 versus a minus 1. Like, so if I have the option,
plus 2. How did I have that?
That'd be a 19 in athletics.
You start to slip, and you catch yourself, and you make it over.
Right.
So that's your movement. I'll still allow you to have an action. So.
Sweet. And, well, am I
I'm in range.
You're surrounded.
Good.
There are forks everywhere. Mm-hmm.
Start, you know, hammering and axing. I did that's my extend stuff. Earlier, so here we go.
Someone says use the goat.
Off-road goats.
Yeah, load the cannon with goats. That's gonna be. Oh, really?
No difference. That. You're planning on increasing.
22 to hit.
I
no, I'm sorry. That's not right.
Possibly
25 to hit.
Hits.
I forgot how to D&D for a second. Yeah. That'll be 12 points magical bludgeoning.
Okay.
That means you're
attack number two.
Smarter and more talkative.
Same to hit.
How much did you say? Sorry.
Oh my god.
You said 13? Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, that would be 10 to hit. Or, I'm sorry, 10 damage. Did you magical bludgeoning. I can math. I promise.
Man.
Okay, so 10 damage.
What did you do to them?
10 damage on the first one. It was magical bludgeoning. And then 10 more on the second one.
All right. I haven't got a number wrong yet.
Magical axe.
I know, I've noticed. At least nothing
you what'd you do to me?
It just took me a minute. I haven't screwed up.
Then 13 hit on the
third. It's a hit?
Yes.
That, I believe, hits. Let me just triple check. 13 will hit.
Yay. That'll be 6 bludgeoning.
Great. So, you see. You see a bunch of orcs come at you. You stab one through the throat. Your polearm goes out the back and stabs the other one head behind it. You kind of like do this and the heads kind of pop off. And you kind of do this roundhouse thing where you like get your polearm stuck in another. And so another orc comes up to try to get you from behind. You just kind of do this with your shield and you actually cut this part off. Just
jeez.
And now you have two orc heads stuck in your polearm.
Aww.
You, multiple orcs now lie at your feet. Rigger.
How far is whirlpool boat?
50 feet.
50 feet.
You got this.
All right. I would like to...
The boat is not surprised, but it does not see you.
I understand. I would like to stow my heavy crossbow.
Okay.
And then I would like to fly... to the boat, but like kind of at sea level, so once I get to the boat, I'm below them, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Like I'm at the bottom. And then, so that would be movement, and I can dash so for 60 feet. And then can I crawl up and do a hand crossbow shot?
Just run stuff.
Hang around there, okay.
Do a hand crossbow. So, is there an area for the catapults where they're throwing rocks? Are they throwing rocks? Are they like launching them, or how?
They're launching them from little crude catapults.
I'm gonna shoot at the catapult crew if
okay.
I can, and then once I do, I'm gonna duck. I'm gonna fly back down with my 10 remaining movement.
Okay,
I believe to the bottom of the ship and put my back against it.
All right, roll your attack.
You say you flew over there?
Yeah.
It's pretty far distance.
Technically not. He's flying. Right?
So you flew over to the... I wasn't paying attention, but you flew over to the other ship.
Yeah.
The ship was 50 feet away.
I know. Just say if he's on the ship, it's going to change what I'm going to do. So.
Oh. Yeah, he is...
If you're on that ship, you're about to get screwed.
He's next to it.
Yeah, he's next to it.
Yeah.
I'm not on it. That'd be a natural 20.
A natural 20 with it?
That boat's about to go to the bottom of the ocean.
This is a hand crossbow.
Oh, man, really?
Yeah.
We'll see about that. Let's see.
Okay.
Hold on.
Yeah,
so I get we sure will.
I get two more for that, and then I should have 1, 2, 3, 4.
Not that I've seen. So man, I haven't gotten any notifications.
Okay.
You can donate. Every dollar that you donate puts you another entry into the raffle for Costume Quest.
For the kids!
Made by Double Fine.
The kids are not made by Double Fine, let's be clear, the game is.
The game is.
Although I'm sure plenty of Double Fine employees have children.
Yeah, they've probably made a few.
The money goes to UCA Children's Hospital, not for us at all.
We take none of it.
And we're actually giving away our own CD keys for things, too, so.
48 damage.
Free.
Alright. To the cannon guy?
To the catapult crew. Catapult
guy? Sweet.
If it's a group of them, like he got to do, I'm just...
So you shoot the one guy, and he's dead.
Okay.
Now there's a group. We'll say you peg them all. Just got, and they
wow.
They slump over, dead, gripping wounds.
They Wilhelm scream.
They.
Yes. We've got the app for this. We need it. No.
Cool. App. And the dwarf ship. So now dwarves are gonna board. No, probably not. And then
Wilhelm scream for 10
dwarves
hours.
Are gonna shoot.
Oh, guys, that's loud.
I muted it. So.
And you see that.
I'm so ready. That'll probably be loud enough.
I'll be throwing more.
Alright, so. Oh. Whoops. There we go. So you see multiple cannon shots land from over here now. Much more accurate, spurred on by your showing them up and do their job.
That's the ticket!
And you see the ship with the splinter of it. So ship two. Alright. Bibblador. nope. Sandry. Sandry gets hit once.
Oh my what? Goodness.
Nat 20.
Oh, of course. They have to crit.
Yeah, no, they were rolling really crappy. Nat 20. I was like, yeah.
They have to crit.
Yeah, it's like what you mean to say, not
Princess of Slime.
Rubbish. Putrescence.
So several orcs hit you for 36 non-magical damage.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. These are rolling more.
How many? 36?
36.
Yeah, that's significant.
Yeah, you'll be fine.
There's a lot of them is how that happened.
Yeah.
So, like...
It's going to be a lot like, less.
Ow! Oh, and that's really all that ship can do. It's also going to take burny damage. Okay, it takes.
Are there a lot of mice on there?
Luckily, there's no mice. You know of. And that is going to bring us to this ship over here. They're going to spend. They're going to move. Just a little bit. They're now within 40 feet. You kind of stay with the ship. Well, yeah, it doesn't really move a whole heck of a lot. So they start assigning more green skins to take over the catapult so they do not shoot. Mm-mm-mm-mm-mm. But they will be able to shoot next round.
Will they?
Probably not, from what I'm hearing. A Bibblador.
I am going to continuously punch my way through.
Bathe in the blood of your enemies.
18 plus 9.
That hits a bunch of orcs.
22.
Hits.
21.
Yeah. And then, oh, that's actually perfect. God, please do enough damage.
So much. This is so much easier if I do it like this.
It's totally fine.
because there's three hits. And then,
Doran, you're next, so whatever you have plans.
Yep, got it. 28. Blood produce, magical blood piercing.
Perfect. So you punch a bunch of orcs. There's one orc that comes at you, and you just... basically do this, and you see his tongue kind of fly out as he bites it off.
Nice.
Smack. You You disembowel many orcs on the ship as they howl in pain. And now I can use this guy for what I intended. And you see a wicked orc come up here, and he's got like two hook hands and a little eye patch and a peg leg. He's like, "Oi, you're gonna have to answer to me now."
Gladly.
He's obviously the captain. Oh, captain, my captain.
He's the chef.
He's going to be obviously dead soon.
Fun story so about that. I had a character in D&D, first session, first night, super excited. The chef in a like dungeon area crit me. I never even got to attack. Crit me.
Oh my god.
I died.
The chef?
Oh, the chef. Yep. It was a great moment for me. Door in the storm.
So, for my action, I would like to change the effect of my control water spell and switch it from whirlpool to part water.
Part water.
In doing so, I cause the water in the area to move apart and create a trench. The trench extends across the spell's area. Separated water forms a wall on either side. Trench remains until the spell ends or I choose a different effect.
Okay.
So, underneath the boat.
Is it all the way down?
How big?
100 foot cube.
So it goes down 100 feet.
Sorry, I'm just thinking something through. Okay, and how deep does it go?
100 feet.
Okay. 100?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm just going to assume you position it in such a way that it doesn't hit this.
Correct.
Since it's closer. Yes. Sweet.
So I was just chilling out down there.
All right, so here's what happens. Rigger, you're kind of like moving around, and you sort of get this sense that like there's something amiss. You kind of look down, and you just sort of see the sea parting, and you kind of like just gonna back away from this. There is now a ship.
Yay!
Oh, the fail! Yeah.
Yes!
That was too good.
I know.
But realistically, you should give him one of yours because that was a shared moment.
Yeah.
That was an amazing.
Well done. Very good teamsmanship. Ship one.
Let.
X marks the spot where that ship died.
Gold.
All did you loot the ship? So that is orc ship number one. It is dead. Let's just take it off the initiative round here.
I was going to start with that, but I thought it would be more fun to try and suck it down the whirlpool.
I like the whirlpool. I really wish they would do more damage to like inanimate objects. Yeah.
Yeah, we might be able to figure out like a much better system for that.
Because like a ship and a sentry. Like, seems like it should all do right. Some damage.
Battle rage is on.
Aye.
Is a big guy in range of me?
Yeah.
All right, I'm gonna go after him.
Huh? Do you have another idea?
That was under 20.
It's gone.
Stupid die. Well, that's gonna be 22 to hit.
Messing with it though.
22.
Cool. That's 8 points magical bludgeoning.
Okay.
And
change the flow.
Non-natural 20.
I will hit.
Another 8 points magical slashing.
Or like, see if you can get enough momentum to launch it upwards.
And.
That'd be amazing.
That'll be 13 to hit.
13 more hits.
Did not think so.
Worthy effort.
The end.
Cool. So you see Sentry kind of go toe to toe with the captain. The captain tries to Edward Scissorhands him, and Sentry is like, whatever, and starts jabbing him like that, dealing quite a lot of damage in the process. That was actually a decent amount. Well done. Rigger at the trigger. There is no longer a boat in front of you.
All right, so I take my second gear bow out and I go to fly up to the rail to shoot again, and then the boat goes down.
You're like, oh.
I told you I got that one.
He calls out across the
sea. So I turn around. How far is it to big guy?
How far can you move?
I mean,
how far can you move?
I can move as far as I need to, but can I get 30? Can I do 30 feet towards him, please?
How far does that get?
Could you?
I'll do my basic 30.
Like, these are supposed to represent bigger squares, but 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. He's very close. You're there.
Can I land on, like, the railing of the boat?
Sure.
All right, I land on the railing. And it's, where's my dad? And then I shoot both of the bolts at the captain.
Sweet.
Dad a seafarer?
Oh, wow. Both the same thing. That'll be a 17 for both.
The what? He was... No one expects the Raider Inquisition. Am I rolling the right amount of dice?
We haven't gotten any donations. If you donate now, probably by the end of this, no one else has. You'll get a game.
One is,
and it's for the kids.
And you'll help sick children.
One is 26, and the second is 8.
You fire these your bolts at him. He hears you say,
"Where's my dad?"
Both bolts go right into his eyes, one that exists and then one that doesn't. And he slumps over like that, and on his way down, he cuts a couple of orcs, and he actually gets his hook stuck. And like, he's stuck in me! And they kind of like drag his body around the deck a little bit, but the captain kind of there, and then they jump out into the ocean.
Nice.
Oh, wait.
He's dead. You only get one. Yeah. All right. That's concludes your turn. Yes, Rieger.
Yeah. I'll search for my dad after combat is over.
Maybe that was your dad. You don't know.
I don't think so.
Donate to clean double. Don't clean double door.
So.
He's a filthy dwarf, and he should stay that way.
You just called your own kind of filthy.
So these orcs, there's only a handful of orcs left. There's quite a few died during initial stuff. The ship is ablaze. It is kind of starting to sink, and you can hear the captain in the back start to issue orders to disengage.
There's another captain.
Dwarf captain.
Oh, dwarf captain.
Yeah,
oh,
okay. He wants to get off the ship because this one is getting ready to start sinking. And the crew, the orc crew that is currently manning it, is very thin. So.
Is it their turn?
It is their turn. They are deciding what to do. They're going to attempt to flee. So you see like a gaggle of orcs running away. Go ahead and take your...
Gaggle.
Yep.
15.
So if you donated, we can certainly verify that. That's not a problem. You donated...
Who'd you donate to?
That's the issue. He has the receipt. He didn't donate, I think, to a person. He donated through...
Oh, just an extra regular
show. So I'm sure we can get you set up. We'll see, like, how many other folks have donated by the end of this. I mean, you could be the only entry, in which case you would get the game. So we'll resolve that once we're at the end. Thank you for your donation. We really appreciate
Thanks,
it.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One applause. Yeah.
Sure. All right. So
that was around that. Hey. No, thank you.
Would you get, by the way, on your thing? Pretty sure you hit.
I got 15.
15 will hit.
I'm
going to kill them all.
Bleep. 10 magical bludge piercing, most likely trying to kick them off of the boat or something. As
you wound quite a few, but kill none.
I got a non-natural 20.
You non-naturally hit them.
That's going to be 11 points.
You manage to kill a couple, and you collect another little head on your little totem pole there. but you wound a few others. And that's gonna... Oh, that ship is dead. These guys are getting ready to disembark. All right, it is now the party's turn.
Hucking it.
I would like to fly after one of the fleeing orc survivors.
Okay.
I listen to my captain.
Oh, right. It's not your turn yet. Sorry.
Okay.
Dorn.
Dorn, just for insult to injury, is going to change the control water spell yet again. And I'm going to use redirect flow, which basically I'm turning the currents of the water in that area to push them deeper.
You don't really see much, but you except little bubbles coming out.
It's just to make sure that they're staying down there.
I'm still on the ship, man.
No, on the other one.
Oh, the other one
that's already sunk.
With the area.
Good. Yeah.
For now. Sentry?
I'm on GTFO. Oh, no. No, I shouldn't have said, oh, no. Alright.
You know what you need to do.
You've got, like, 5 inspiration.
Yep.
You're fine.
Oh, good. Because I rolled a 20.
Not 20.
No, we didn't.
Yep. Shut up.
I'd also...
Shut up.
I'd also, once I got back, try to find some more rope.
Shut up there, bud.
Obviously, mine was lost.
You tie yourself to the ship successfully. Well done. And then... All right. So, Rigger.
Are they running off and just, like, jumping off the edge?
Yeah.
All right.
A bunch are jumping off the edge. Some are trying to go below deck.
I'm going to fly to one that is, like, running to the edge. I'm going to, like, grab him and... growl in his ear in orc.
Tell Urosh Kilgrek serves him faithfully, and then I'm gonna push him off the edge.
Okay.
He's like, Urosh!
What?
Wait, who? You have a
rat? Do you fly back or?
Yeah, then I'm gonna leave. Yeah.
Well, Dorf.
Bjork. So you nailed that landing. At this point, the ship has sunk. This one, like, it's going down, it's capsizing. That ship, both ships are blet. The party has survived. And the ship suffered no damage.
Perfect victory!
I bust out my ale.
What?
Bust out my ale.
There is much celebration aboard the ship. The crew has a newfound level of respect for you, and they're quite pleased.
Even me?
Yeah, even you.
Hey.
And I think that's actually an excellent point to cap off the night, since we are pretty close to closing time.
Yeah.
Were we able to...
If I get a message with...
Okay, I don't think there were any other donations, though.
No.
Right? So, if you were able to get that sent over the Tails, he can confirm all that and get you hooked up with the game. Again, that game is Costume Quest. We didn't get any other donations, so as long as we can verify that, you're good. Thanks again for that donation. Thanks for everybody who tuned in. It was a great night. You can expect quite a few more ship shenanigans in the future.
Also, this weekend on Saturday, the 25th, we'll be doing an Extra Life stream from 1 to 5, probably starting off playing Broforce, but we'll have other games throughout the day as well. Hopefully there will be some new faces there that you guys haven't seen. And yeah, I don't know. Come see. There's going to be donation raffles, and there will be raffles that you don't have to donate for. All sorts of good stuff. So come back and watch us play.
Fantastic. All right. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. We will see you next week.
Have a good one, Saturday. Thank you.
Thank you.
A little combi.
Bye.
Bye.